kind of St. Patrick's music should we play? We're live now, guys.
Whiskey top in the jar. The morning?
Anything by YouTube would qualify.
What's considered Sam? What's considered
Whiskey in the jar. Danny Boy. Danny Boy. Brian? Brian? Danny Boy.
Danny Boy?
That's Irish. You're right. He's right. Danny Boy is Irish.
Danny Boy. Get us going in the mood tonight. How is everybody?
All right. Perfect.
Oh, doing good.
We are live.
In honor of St. Patrick's Day, we're playing Danny Boy by the Irish Tenors.
Sweet.
Back by popular demand.
Oh, boy, the pipes are calling from end to glen.
You guys sing really good.
The summer's gone and all the roses die. It's you, must go, and I must fly. But call me back when summer's in the meadow, or when the valley's hot and white hot, is I'll be.
Such a beautiful song, you guys.
Wow.
Yeah, it was.
Thank you for suggesting that one. That reminds me of St. Patty's Day has always reminded me of my grandmother, because that was the day she was born, St. Patty's Day. And actually her name was Helen Patricia. I guess after St. Patty's Day, Patricia. So and she passed away September 3rd, 2016.
Wow.
And that's one thing me and you have in common, Teresa, about September 3rd. I know, in case we ever...
Yes, my biological grandmother, who has adopted me, September 3rd is when she passed away.
Wow.
Yep.
So speaking of, we were talking about the dead. We really need to pray for the dead as well. Melissa, you had some prayers planned for us tonight?
Yeah, are you ready?
Yes, go ahead.
Dear Heavenly Father, we come to you in this hour asking for your divine blessing and for the Holy Spirit to help us as we are gathered together. We pray for guidance as we proceed forward tonight. Give us clear instruction on how to conduct on your words. Give us the desire we need for the gifts you have given to each one of us as we are and do make up the body of Christ. Thank you for giving us eyes to see and ears to hear, Lord, and allowing us to come forth. Lord, and thank you for the drive that we all have for the truth. And we just thank you all for all this in Jesus Christ's name. Amen.
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 And I also want to say, I also want to say prayers for the sick. A couple mentions we have, and I'm sure there's some other mentions as well. I know Lisa's dad is going through some surgery right now.
Yeah.
So pray that through Jesus Christ that he gets better pretty quickly and that he's up and at him again. You know, just I think it'll be good. So anyway, I also want to pray for Harold's daughter. You want to talk about that, Harold?
Yeah, I sure. It's a long story, I guess, but why don't we pray? Why don't we pray first, and then I'll tell the story because it's a relatively long story. So
that's a good story.
That's fine. It is. Yeah. A good story. It's it could be it. To me, it's testimony. I think so.
Yeah. Definitely. Okay. If you'd really like me to tell it, I will.
Go ahead.
Okay.
Free to answer.
Yeah. I was out with my daughter last week, and my daughter had told me while we were out that she felt something underneath my bed. Now, my daughter is sensitive to spirits, and I guess you could call her a spirit medium, but she's, you know, all I know is she can see them. You know, she sees them wherever they are. So she said to me that there was a shadow being underneath my bed, and I should deal with it. And I said, I will. When we come back, I'll take care of it. And when we came back, I came upstairs, and I had left my food downstairs, and I ran to the bathroom, and she came up with my food, and she was sitting on the stairs waiting for me to come out of the bathroom. And all of a sudden, I heard her scream, and I heard a bunch of noise, and I came running out of the bathroom. I'm like, what's going on? And apparently, something pushed her from the top of the stairs to the bottom. Yeah. She was sitting on the stairs, and she was literally pushed off of the stairs and rolled down the stairs. And she ended up, she fractured her hand, and she sprained her neck, and now we thought her foot was just fractured, but now we're finding it's broken. And she's probably going to need a cast on her foot because it swelled up really, really badly. So that night, I went back into the bathroom after she had went downstairs and we had taken care of stuff. We were going to go to the doctor in the morning. And while I was sitting in the bathroom, I opened the door and I saw the shadow things just sitting there on the ledge of the landing. And I just, you know, anger came through me, but it was a righteous anger, you know, and I got up and in the name of Jesus Christ, I banished the crap out of that thing. And I called down an angel, Archangel Michael, and he came and he hit this thing with a sword and blew it completely through a wall.
Wow.
I mean, I got the strange feeling because my daughter had told me it wasn't a shadow and it wasn't a demon. It was something else. And she called it a dimensional being, but I suspect it may have been a djinn. DJINN. Djinn is they're a spirit
like a
that
genie.
Yeah, well it's been around since the beginning. Apparently their story goes all the way back to before we were created. God created them and created the angels. And apparently, when he created man, he asked the angels to bow before man, and they did. And he turned to the djinn and he told them to bow before man, and they refused because they said that, you know, they were superior to man. So God banished them from the planet, basically, all of them. to another dimension. Yeah, somewhere between the worlds is what it said. And, you know, they were basically smokeless fire was what they look like. But they're shapeshifters. They can look like anything. Just like the angels were holy light and they could look like anything. Well, these things have one sect of these jinn, they want to get back to Earth, basically. And they were given till the end of time to prove that man is inferior to them. And so far, you know, they haven't. But they've been in the Middle East a lot. You know, the Middle Eastern people have dealt with them for, you know, a couple thousand years now. You know, they consider them demons. Because the sect of Jinn that wants to come back to the planet basically and it doesn't hate man, but doesn't like us very much. So they do a lot of bad, you know. And so they consider them demons. Basically, and yeah. I don't know how this thing got here. I mean, you know, I didn't call it. So,
well, whatever it is, they don't like Jesus Christ. They don't like to hear the name. They run in the other direction.
One of the things is when Harold and I talked about this a long time ago about this, demonology, about devils, and I called it when we were talking about it. I think the last time I said ethereal. They're here.
Yeah. Yeah.
They're here on this side. Yeah. And one of the things is that we think of them as just mischievous, that they're messing around, but they don't just mess around. That's the problem. There's a reason behind what they're doing, but we'll never find out what that reason is.
Yeah,
they are multi-level chess players, dimensional chess players. They do things for a reason that we may not even guess at for 3, 5, 10, 15 years. Sometimes after someone dies and you realize, hey, this is what that's, you know, if they weren't taken out, this wouldn't happen and that wouldn't happen. I wonder if that has something to do with that attack.
Yeah.
And,
you know, that's what happens. It's terrible. But go ahead, Harold.
Well, no. I don't. Go ahead, please.
No,
go ahead,
Corey. I just wanted to say that your story kind of relates to what happened 2 days ago. My mom, like, just suddenly fell into a mirror and I feel bad because you're saying about shadows and stuff. And
yeah.
It was like about 4 days earlier, I was walking out of the bathroom and I seen, like, to me, like a shadow. And I actually went back into the bathroom and opened the door again to see if I wasn't imagining it.
Yeah.
And I didn't see it again, but she went face first into a mirror like 2 days ago, and she
Here's the thing: mirrors are portals. Okay,
mirrors. It's funny that you said not funny.
Yeah,
not funny. Funny.
No,
strange that you said mirror. What did your mom say exactly about falling into a mirror?
Yeah.
What did she exactly say?
No, it was just the fact that I think that it was the shadow thing that I saw, and I feel guilty about seeing. It was just an old mirror that she had. It wasn't even like, it's not a wall mirror. It was just something she had like off to the side. It wasn't even like put up or anything. And it was kind of precious to her, so she kind of put it off to the side. And when she fell, she just happened to hit her head into the mirror, and and like luckily like there was no glass or anything that, you know, went into her head or anything, but but I'm stupid, but like I saw that shadow thing and it really hit me at that time. It was weird.
Did you remember immediately?
Yeah.
Well, I'm glad you're saying this too, because I've got a dresser that has a huge mirror on it, and as of recent, you know, every night when I go to bed, just before I go to bed, actually, I pray, and I've been seeing, you know, these really bizarre, almost watery kind of silhouettes that have been really active, above my bed when I
love you.
No, in front of me, like dancing almost. I don't know. how to explain it, but really active, hyperactive. And there's some on the side that are almost kind of watching, you know, not so active, but there's one that's particularly active. That's right there in front of me as I'm praying. Like it's really taking offense to what I'm doing. And I have a huge mirror that's close by. And I'm wondering, is that something that, that's, you know,
cover the mirror,
cover the mirror.
Absolutely. Yeah. Cover the mirror.
Oh yeah.
Okay.
Oh yeah.
So cover the mirror. Okay.
Yeah, and also dark spaces sometimes can act as portals, like
basements. Natural light. You need to flood it with natural light.
Closets.
Yeah, natural light. Open it up.
Upstairs, you know, up in the attic, you know, in the crawl spaces, they show up. They use those as portals. My wife used to have a closet that was acting as a portal. She had a big, huge walk-in closet, and this thing, it would pop the doors open at night. I used to watch it. I'd sit and watch the doors come open, you know? Yeah. So, yeah, it was really active, that thing. But I can tell you.
They hate natural light, and they love mirrors. Cover the mirrors or get rid of them altogether.
Yep, exactly. Exactly.
Well, you know, is that the one thing that we have in common here? Because, you know, I've been trying to find, you know, some kind of congruency with all of us. And that's one thing that I've seemed to notice is the running theme is that we all have had experiences with something supernatural, you know, meaning like ghosts or, you know, some kind of entity, be it alien or ghost or whatever, that is running, you know, kind of amongst all of us. Is that true? Is everyone here, you know, I'm bored with that.
No, I've had a bunch.
Some people are more aware than others. They could have just as much experience as you do, Troy, but they don't understand what's going on, so they don't comment on it. They've been experiencing stuff all their life, but they don't know.
Right.
You see? Some people just don't know.
I agree.
Exactly. Even like Heavenly Dreams. Sorry, Corey. Even like Heavenly Dreams, things like that, because I've had a number of those. As a recent, I sent you guys a message a little while back, I believe, that, you know, I had a dream here as a recent that my head was actually elongated, you know, that I actually had, like, you know, the elongated, like, you know, Egyptian kind of skull, which was so real to me, and I freaked out, and I woke up. It wasn't one of those things where I got scared awake by anything that jumped out at me. I just simply looked at myself. And it was like me out of my body looking back at myself and my head was like in my skull was actually like you'd see in like the, you know, like in a museum that my head was, you know, elongated. And I freaked out because I was like, how the hell am I going to put a hat on? You know, and I'm, you know what I mean? Right. And it looked weird for me. And I panicked and I woke up and I didn't know how to explain it.
Did you check your head real quick?
Yeah. Well, that was, of course. That's the first thing I did. That was the first thing I did. I'm like, oh, I got that. Cool. My head's like still like in the same shape, but you know.
Just real quick there. I just wanted to say that with the, I agree with Ty and Harold, definitely cover the mirrors because
it
is a portal. Right. And Teresa brought up something about in the skull now. There's like if you feel in the top of your head, it's like a Hellboy kind of horn thing going on now.
Now that's weird because I what's weird is that I was struck in my head back when I was a kid, and I always had a permanent lump, you know, from when I was I was hit with a wiffle bat. I don't want to get into any kind of specifics of you know, who and why or what, but, you know, I was hit in the head with a wiffle ball bat, and it always left, like, you know, this lump that was on my skull, and I could always feel it. But now I can't feel that any longer, so that's gone. But I'm trying to figure out because I did hear about that, and I don't really feel too many lumps, but I have looked at my eyes, and I'll redirect this towards that just briefly, and my eyes are completely hexagon, and I've seen that, and I gotta take a picture of my eyes just to validate that with all you guys, but my eyes are hexagon, and I'm wondering why that is. You know,
well, remember the light of the body is in the eye, right? It's the eye gate. That's what it is. So
yeah,
right. Light of the soul is the eyes, you know, or the eye gate, you know. That's what it is.
Is that what it is? I mean, does everyone here experience the same thing? Are we all getting hexagon, or are you guys getting it too?
I haven't looked.
I don't think so. I have maybe a triangle. I don't know.
Yeah,
triangle.
I'm not a mirror guy.
Yeah,
no,
I don't look in the mirror, so
yeah, I can't tell. You got to do that, guys. You know, everyone's got to look in the mirror right now because, you know, well, even walking by, I've got this little place that I eat breakfast on occasion. It's called Polly's Pies. Really great food, but I'm not here to promote them. The fact
do they
is
have good
that
pies?
They have great pies. And so I was walking by some of the pictures that they have of, like, you know, the history of Polly's Pies. And I'm looking at the people that are in these pictures, and everyone has hexagonal eyes. It's
yes,
the
they
craziest.
Do.
They yep. don't have, like, the pupils like you. Like, I mean, it's like an artist would, like, you know, and they, you know, I'm sure that, you know, it's just so strange that I'm looking at these pictures, and every one of these pictures, I mean, right. I'm talking like one or two. I'm talking everyone in these pictures has hexagonal eyes. And it
Brian?
Doesn't make any sense of why this is happening.
Do you have a hexagonal eye? Yeah.
Do you have a picture of a hexagonal eye to share?
Yeah, I'll show it.
Thank you.
So if anyone out there, you know, hasn't taken a good look at their eyes, they may want to do that, and you're going to see some, you know, I would say majority of people that are experiencing this for sure are going to see some, you know, some definite jagged, you know, the you know, the jig-jag of your eyes are not round any longer.
You know, Troy, there's a few people that I use as as a gauges, other than just the effects. I look and see how other people are doing. There's, you know, three or four people I use as a gauge. I look at them, I see how they're doing.
Is this here to identify the people that are actually,
Brian,
you know, experiencing this?
Brian, look up
look at that
Gerber baby
right there. Hexagon alive.
Who is that?
I don't know.
That's Stacy from accounting. I don't know.
Oh, okay.
I don't know who it is.
I'm just asking.
I don't know who it is.
Somebody
I thought maybe
there.
You knew.
No, I don't know.
No, Teresa found the Gerber baby.
Now, did the Gerber baby have hexagonal eye?
Yep.
Really?
Yep.
That's crazy.
It does now.
That's crazy. But I use it as a gauge so I can tell what's real and what's not, because you understand.
Yeah.
I can kind of see the hexagonal eyes. You guys see that? That's...
That's not
anatomically correct the way it's the way we remember.
Wow.
But Teresa was showing me some residue, which, by the way, Teresa, you look good in green, by the way. There you go.
Good.
That picture you sent me, Teresa, of
So is that her a four-leaf clover or something?
Yeah. Not a four-leaf clover. Shamrocks are three. Four-leaf clovers are not shamrocks.
Okay.
How many of you guys remember the sun having sunglasses from Raisin Bran? That just.
I remember the raisins having sunglasses.
Yeah, me too. The California raisins.
Yeah. Yeah, heard it on the grapevine.
But
come on.
Yep. No, but the Raisin Bran sun. Always had the sunglasses. You know, you can see a lot of this stuff, you know, the residue on, like, you know, even like Rick and Morty. I was watching that the other night where they had, like, you know, something that was actually related to the Mandela effect, like, you know, mind control. It was mind control. It was, I gotta look at the episode, but it was one where the parasites were invading your mind. You know, the people's minds, and actually making them believe things that weren't even real. Yes. And
that sounds familiar.
What was that show?
It's called Rick and Morty, and you know what? It's Dan Roiland and Dan Harmon and Paul Roiland.
No.
I want to say.
Great.
And
all these guys. It's Rick and Morty. If you haven't seen it, I want to say that this whole thing, I can't be completely conclusive on this, but if you guys have ever seen Rick and Morty, let me tell you, I think it's definitely a symbol or a sign, something indicating that this right here is, I mean, obviously what they're doing is a play on it because it's simply a cartoon, but what they're doing is making a lot of reference to the Mandela effect.
And dimensional portals, everything.
It's not time travel. They're saying it's not time travel. They're very specific on this too, and it's right. A very intelligent cartoon. And it's very funny. You know, a lot of these things are like, you know, outlandish, but the whole premise of it is simply this is the Mandela effect, guys. It's crazy. It's absurd. Yeah. And the main guy that actually plays the role of Rick Sanchez is a guy that is simply is going through the same kind of things that we are.
Yeah,
that
no
feels
doubt.
Like he's that feels like he's absolutely alone because he doesn't have that. Yeah,
the guy Rick on the show is absolutely alone. He's the only one who knows what's going on. Everyone
he knows
else
exactly.
Is just a participant.
Correct. And if you haven't seen it, I'm not here to promote here Rick and Morty. That's not what
Stop
I'm doing.
Promoting it. Stop promoting it, Rick.
Thank you. Right,
exactly. I'm just saying, if you haven't seen it, you might want to just, you know, just to kind of, you know, have something to relate to in some funny way. It is funny, and it definitely has a lot of relevance. And I would pinpoint it, and I would definitely say this is something that is certainly something that is. I don't know if it's an Emmy all by itself because
if
it's even.
If you are stressed out over the Emmy, watch Rick and Morty.
Yeah, watch Rick and Morty. You'll have a great time. It's very, very funny. Extremely intelligent. If you're, you know, not at that caliber, you'll still enjoy it because it's just, you know, there's a lot of, like, you know, crazy violence. But the fact is that,
cartoon,
you know, it's just, yeah, exactly. But if you actually listen to what the dynamic and the dialogue is, it is absolutely one of the most intelligent, brilliant, you know, cartoons I've ever seen. That's not my point. Why I'm even here? I'm not here to promote that.
Are you sure?
You know, there's a lot of things that have been going on recently, guys. And I don't know if it's my turn in the queue to actually mention anything, but certainly I'd like to have a couple minutes to, you know, kind of share with you of what I've experienced here within the last week.
Go ahead, Troy. But not to mention, don't forget about Australia. We got to talk about that too.
Oh, man, that's crazy. Let's bring that up first since you said that. Okay, so everyone knows of Australia that it's moved up here. You know, it's not the land down under any longer, right?
Yeah.
Right, because you
New
know
Zealand,
that...
And New Zealand moved with it.
Certainly it did, and everything's been shifting all over the place. Well, let me give credit where credit is due. You know, my good friend Lone Eagle, you guys probably know him.
Yeah,
if you
yeah.
haven't subscribed, you probably yeah. should because he's yeah. a master of continental shift, and you know he's definitely delivering the right message of you know, don't live in fear, you know, listen guys, you know, we're all together, we're finding each other, you know, and you know, thank God that we actually did, because it would really suck to actually go through this thing alone. That being said is that, you know, he brings attention to a lot of things, you know, continentally that have not been addressed, and he's really on point with a lot of these things. Well, so he's mentioned, you know, obviously Australia before, but I was looking this morning. In fact, I was with Regatto. You guys know Regatto Bonner. If you don't,
yes,
you know,
yeah, sure. Yeah.
Sure. he's a friend of mine, and in fact, we're working together now. So. We actually have an allegiance, and that's kind of rare to hear in this forum, is that two of us have actually, you know, connected, you know, personally, we actually work together and we kind of got each other's backs kind of, if you will.
Yeah.
So we see it, we're down with what's going on and no one's going to F with us, and we're in a safe environment. So if you're worried about Regatto, well, you should be still, you know, because, you know, he's still going through the same stuff, but you know, I got his back and he's got mine as well. So. That being said, is that we're looking at this thing, this little anomaly about Australia, and we take a look at, if you haven't seen Google Maps or any kind of maps, later on, maybe just reference this, or if you can right now, pull it up. You'll see that Australia itself is missing a gigantic chunk out of its side. And in fact, the funny part about this is that the ocean, as far as I know, has been renamed. And the ocean itself is named the Great Australian Bight. Like something took a big chunk out of Australia, and it's gigantic. It actually, it just whomped on Australia. It's huge. And if you haven't seen it, take a look at it. And
is that in the bottom?
It's at the bottom, correct. And it actually looks like a chomp mark too. And
wow.
Actually, but it's not spelled like B-I-T-E. It's spelled B-I-G-H-T. And this is the ocean. This is the ocean. This is the ocean around, right below Australia. And if you haven't seen it, take a look at it, because that's so ironic that it's actually named the Great Australian Bight, that actually took a huge chunk of Australia. Because guess what? Australia is not what you think it is now. If you can envision it in your mind, guess what? It's not that any longer. And if you think about it like this, there had to be millions of people that were affected out of this huge chunk. Where did they go?
Was there a town or a city in that area before?
I'm not certain, man. I just looked at it and I went, that's wrong and that's huge and that's scary. There's something that happened and definitely something
and
how
about
was
at
taken
the top?
Away from that area.
What about at the top of Australia? Was that did that always look like that with a missing thing in the top there?
Right here?
You know
right there.
That was like that. That was that's actually what I remember. It would look like a dog's head to me.
Okay, so it's funny you say that, because initially, you know, that the reason why they called it the Land Down Under, because it wasn't part of like pretty much anything else. It wasn't all these islands at the very top of it. It kind of stood alone. But now it's up there near Indonesia, and they got all the other islands that are kind of congregating around it as well.
So that's
certainly a new thing for me, you know, and that's just the way this new world is. And
where's New Zealand? Is New Zealand above it?
Upper right-hand side, it's actually part of the northeast, and that's where all the kangaroos, the real kangaroos live, not the ones that are actually hanging out in trees now.
So you're telling me that New Zealand is actually where the kangaroos are now?
That's where the kangaroos are now, correct.
Really?
Well, Australia has kangaroos, but majority of kangaroos in Australia now actually live in trees. So if you thought that kangaroos were prevalent in Australia, you may want to take a look at the real fact of that. You know, now New Zealand is the predominant, you know, real kangaroos that hop on the ground.
Sorry, because that Tasmania looks like it drifted farther south away.
I was just thinking that too. Tasmania looks like it's down away from
it's too far south
from Australia.
And look at this coastline. Looks like a turkey gobbler or something.
The thing I want to bring up. You guys hear me okay?
Yeah, I can hear you.
We can hear you, Ty.
I want to bring up is very early on in the ME, I happened to come across people from Australia, and it took me a few times talking to them, and I finally realized that they were in Australia and were affected by the ME. They saw the changes as we see them, but the people that lived in Australia that weren't affected lived there and yet did not notice the changes. They didn't see them.
What happened to the people that were living in that big chunk there?
That's my point, is that there was a huge – I mean, we're talking about, you know, civilizations that have been there for a long, long time, and people that have known each other forever. And now that whole big chunk is gone.
And they're screaming.
Brian? Brian?
Yes?
How many people are – what's the – what's the population now of Australia?
It's got to be what?
We can look that up real quick.
I got it.
All right. I just want to see how many people were there and how many people there are now there.
Teresa, you're my stat person. Can you look that up for me real quick? What's the statistics? Population?
I got it.
What? You got it?
Population of Australia.
Population for what?
Yeah.
Australia.
Already, no big deal. Population of Australia, it's got a landmass of 7.6 million kilometers, which is 0.9 million miles. Okay. Population 2018 estimates of just under 25 million.
Does that sound right to you?
No.
What do you need me for?
I thought that'd
be. You know, I never looked at the stats of Australia, and now I'm kind of kicking my ass that I did not know what the stats were because I didn't know.
That doesn't seem like that doesn't seem like it's right. It seems like they had more people.
Well, I would imagine they probably been around for a long, long time.
So yeah, sure has.
It just didn't come up, so that seems very small for something that has 2 million square miles.
All right, they have Sydney still there, right?
3 million square miles.
Okay, Sydney's still there.
Well, and Sydney was the original capital, by the way. If Sydney was the original capital of Australia.
Now it's Canberra, right?
It's Canberra. Exactly. Canberra or Canberra.
Canberra.
It was never Sydney, by the way. It wasn't changed. It wasn't changed, you know, by like, you know, some kind of legal sense. It's always been Canberra or Canberra, whatever it is now.
No. It was Sydney, I think.
It was Sydney. It was certainly Sydney. It was always Sydney. And so that's what I recall anyway. So if anyone's out there going, oh, no, it was always Canberra. Okay, fine. You're right. Then, you know, and you may be right. But, you know, maybe you don't get this and it doesn't matter, you know, what I say to you because you're not going to get it.
What, Ty?
To give me an example of the problem with the population of Australia, as I said, 2.9 million square miles.
Yeah.
Canada has 3.8 million square miles. So 2.9 for Australia, 3.8 million for Canada. And of course, Canada's population is 35 million.
Yeah.
Okay. So you see, Australia has more than enough room for more people. There's no doubt about it. Okay,
but didn't they have, they had a lot of natives though, didn't they? They had a lot of, you know, tribes that were out in the Outback.
You are hitting on such a really, you know, an impressive, you know, context right here because I was going to make this, you know, a topic later on. We can cover this briefly. You know, it's funny because when people think of natives, you know, a lot of the people, in fact, I'll touch on this really quick. And I don't want to cover it too much, but I do know a lot about the native history of a lot of different places. And you know, just out there really quick, everyone here, when you hear the word Negro, okay, the word Negro, N-E-G-R-O, what's the first thing that comes to your mind? Anyone?
Africa
or someone that's
black.
A Native American.
Black.
Yeah.
Negro means
right.
Black.
Exactly. Yeah. Exactly. That's exactly what you would think because it's even the color that's depicted when you're speaking Spanish. Negro means black, correct?
Yeah,
of course
Negro.
It does. It means Negro, and then that means black. You know, and Blanco, white, and all that. Okay, so we understand that whole connection. Now, if you look at the real meaning of what the word Negro means, it does not mean black at all. In fact,
what does it mean?
What it really means is this, and this is definitely in my mind's eye is certainly an ME, which is anyone that is an indigenous to any particular country. It doesn't matter which country that you're in, you are considered a Negro. So you can be a Negro African, you can be a Negro Australian, you can be a Negro Brazilian. It doesn't matter where you're at, you are now a Negro. So the term Negro is actually irrelevant. It doesn't make any relevance or sense to anything particular to being black. So the whole Spanish meaning of black is absolutely incorrect. So when they say you're Negro, that makes no sense. So when Spanish people say it's Negro, well, that means it's pretty much anything you want it to be.
You're thinking that something is changing the historical record in the back to change the definition of what, including the indigenous people.
It's confusing everything, Ty, is what it is. Yeah. It's saying it's whatever we want it to be. And don't even make any kind of conclusion, because guess what? If you think Negro means black, you're wrong. It means everything. It means everything and anything that was indigenous to any particular country. Look at it. In fact, if you look it up in history, it actually says Negro Africans. So it's a double, perceptive term that actually is saying you're a black. So you're now a Negro Australian, you're a Negro European. It doesn't matter where you are, and if you're not understanding what I'm talking about, look it up. Look at where you are. a Negro actually means that you are indigenous to a particular area, and it's not mean in any kind of derivative term by any means, because it simply means that you are indigenous
derogatory,
now.
Derogatory term, yeah.
No, derogatory, exactly. Thank you, Ty. Yeah, exactly.
But yeah, no, that is incorrect. Because Negro simply means black. That's the definition of the word.
It's always been black.
And that, my friends, is the meaning of the M-E. You know, so if you don't think it, you know what the Mandela effect is all about. Well, guess what? That is pretty particular. And if you've ever known Negro, and it actually has a relation to the Mexican terminology for meaning black, well, guess what? You might want to question why we're actually saying that the M-E is actually real. So it actually has some relevance.
Did you find out if blanco still means white?
I haven't gone that far, bud, but you're leading me down some trails.
Hey, guys, I just want to say welcome to Bluebeard. Special shout out. He's in our audience.
Hey, Bluebeard. Welcome.
Bluebeard's here. Yay.
Bluebeard, hey. I want to hear from you. I got
Bluebeard's here.
I've been listening to you for a little bit, man. I want to go ahead. I want to hear your story.
He can tell us about Australia.
Can you get him on the show, Brian?
Bluebeard, your native country has been chomped, buddy. Please tell me how you feel.
Brian, can you get him on the show?
Are you grieving for your millions at least that have been chomped up by the Great American Bite? What is that? The Great American Bite? That's a new ocean. Why wouldn't they call it like Great American Bite Ocean?
Did you change this to the Great Barrier Reef?
No, it's Great American Bite. That's what it's called, bud. Look it up.
The Great Barrier Reef. Any changes to that?
Oh, I haven't even looked at that, but it was used to be the northeastern part of Australia, and I want to check that out. I wonder if it's even still there. I don't even know, but I'm certainly curious. But I've been looking up so many other things, like the World's Fair and all these other things that you guys are going to flip out when you hear.
It's off the coast of Queensland.
Thinks you're calling him names.
Yeah, I guess he thought you were calling him.
He misunderstood. Somebody needs to apologize. I think Bluebeard thinks you're calling him a name.
No.
No, we're kidding.
You might want to clarify that.
Yeah, can you clarify that?
He should know us. He should know us better than that.
Somebody say something.
Something.
Bluebeard, we apologize if we offended you, brother.
We apologize to whoever.
We were talking about a piece of the ocean.
Oh, Stonebender said, "I think he's kidding."
Come on, Bluebeard.
You can't tell any these days with the Mandela effect. You know what's real and what's not real. Brian, you gonna show some residue that I sent you?
I'm giving everyone their freedom to go ahead and jump on in. Otherwise, I got some more stuff to talk to you guys about.
Okay, what else you got, Troy?
All right. Well, you know what? I want to tell you guys about some tech before it's time. In fact, you know, I had mentioned that I'm working with Lone Eagle. You know, if anyone here knows Lone Eagle, you know what I'm talking about. This guy's on point. Really, you know, a really genuine guy.
We got a new listener.
And so he was mentioning that there was some tech before its time, and simply there was some robots that were created before robots should have actually been invented. You know, Ty, you were talking about a particular robot that you knew earlier, which I did too. That was the first robot that I remembered. Can you kind of give everyone, you know, kind of rundown on what that's all about?
Well, I was talking about Robbie the robot, and of course.
Oh, I know Robbie.
This is the one that was before the Lost in Space robot that you know so well.
Yep.
But this robot that Troy's talking about is, of course, Electro, from 1939.
Okay, I know that.
It is 1939. Right. And Brian,
the big one, right?
I want you guys to hold tight, because that's not the only one, but you know, there's going to be something that's going to really astonish you. If you haven't seen the Lone Eagle video, hold off for just a second. You'll see more of the fun stuff The thing that I really wanted to point out, which was truly astonishing for me, was not just the fact that it was a robot that was, you know, it was completely, you know, I mean, it was coded. You had to talk a certain way for it to, you know, to react, yeah, you know, the way that you wanted it, to.
It was not Robbie. It was not the Lost in Space. It was more human-oriented. That's
the thing
point.
Was, oops, correct, you know, but you created a robot essentially to smoke a cigarette, you know.
I remember that one. Yeah, I know that one.
You know the one, okay?
And he would walk forward.
He'd walk forward, and he'd blow up balloons, and he'd essentially pop them as well. So you recall this this robot called Electro, correct?
Yes, absolutely.
Okay. I think you're probably one of the few, and that's okay. You know, and that's perfectly fine that you remember that.
I saw a documentary on him and the man who controlled him.
How long did you see the documentary?
Must have been like a couple months ago, because
that could still be an Emmy.
Because he had a thing in his hand, and he used to push buttons, and he would hold it up, and he would say something into it, like you know, walk forward, and it would walk forward. Mm-hmm. And he said that it was the most advanced thing they had had at that point, and he never thought they would have anything more than that. You know.
I'm glad you said that, because you know, in this day and age, there was one thing that was said to me that actually resonated very well, which is that we're very especially with YouTube and Facebook and all these things, we're very, very impressionable, and we grab onto memes very, very, you know. And if you don't know what memes are, go on the internet. We grab onto old things that used to be, and we kind of turn them into something that is kind of funny. We laugh at it, and, you know, and we say, you know, that's funny. You remind me of, like, Electro the Robot, you know?
Yeah.
You know what I mean? And I've never, ever, ever, ever seen not even one single meme ever even referring to Electro the Robot. This is one of the standards now. Apparently, that has actually set the template for robotics, and this is Westinghouse, and Westinghouse was certainly a powerhouse back in the day. I can't deny that, you know. But the fact is that I'm certain that we would have known about this somewhere. We would have seen this. I've seen so many different programs. I would have known about this. You guys would have known about this. I'm certain somebody out there would have known about this first robot. And you know, as far as I'm concerned, like what Ty was addressing was, I know Robbie the Robot, and that was like one of the first things that I ever knew. So there had to be some kind of reference somewhere, a documentary, you know, something that would say, oh, no, Robbie the Robot wasn't actually the first one, but it was actually blah, 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 blah. You know, it was this guy. Okay, now watch, guys. Watch. I want you guys to pay attention, because I just mentioned you know, this one robot.
Electro,
yeah. Exactly. Well, you know, before I get too far, Electro actually had a dog, and his name is, I want to say, Sparky or Sparko.
Yeah.
Which was created down the line, just so I'm not leaving that out, and that's up to you guys to go ahead and check out. Just to, you know, you guys should be having like little notepads to you know, follow through on, to make sure that I'm being, you know, thorough here, and I'm checking out with everything that I'm saying, because, you know, who knows, you know, I could be full of shit as far as you know.
Well, Troy, what happened, the reason I watched the documentary or whatever, there was this girl who's an engineer, and what she does is she goes around and she looks at old, you know, engineering things, basically. And her thing was, she went to the old Westinghouse place and looked at this. It's basically in a building where, you know, it looks like it's, you know, a derelict building that this robot is in. And there's two versions of it. And one version is up on a thing, like on a pedestal or something. And another one was like over off to the side. And she actually climbed inside the back of the robot. And was showing how it worked, you know, how all the parts worked, how they used these tubes, vacuum tubes, for different things, like his eyes lit up, and Then they showed the hand thing that, that the guy used to talk into.
Hey, Brian, and show the face so you can see the eyes and the moving parts on this body if you can.
I just remember
it. I'd like the audience to see what we're talking about in reference. Now, and I get you, and I get you, and this is Harold, yeah?
Guys, yeah.
Okay, Harold, Harold, check this out. And you're right, and you're absolutely right on what you're talking about, and I bet it's true. I bet everything you're saying is 100% true. Now, let me go a step further, if I can, just to elaborate, so I'm not monopolizing the whole entire time. We can make room for, you know, other people that have other things to share. So, really quick, guys. That's fine. So here you have Electro and his dog Sparky, or Sparko, I think that's what they call him. You can look that up for yourself if you so desire, but there's a little dog that goes along with him too, by the way. I don't know if he like smokes cigarettes and stuff or whatever, but he does something else. There's another robot out there, really quick, Brian, get ready. His name is Alpha. And this his name is Alpha. Alpha the robot, and Brian, if you can look that, you know, just pull that up. Alpha, you know, like Alpha, you know, Beta, Romeda, you know. Okay, pull up Alpha robot, and then you'll see what I mean. It's another robot that actually is much more creepy than good old Electro. You'll think of this guy in a much different sense, simply because the questions. If you haven't seen the videos, you gotta see the videos. Oh my god! And I don't want to I don't want to strike you out by Brian. You can't play them because they'll strike you out for whatever reasons that they do. But you know, we're strike. Apparently, in other people's eyes, we're not telling anyone, you know, exactly what's really going on. But we're like, you know, controversial, and you know, and there's, you know, subject matter that shouldn't be discussed because it just, you know. It's not for listening ears of people that have eyes open want to hear. So that being said, listen, just pull the pictures of Alpha Robot. You'll see there's another robot. You can actually play some of the video if you want. I know that there's actually some YouTube video on this. And I want you to take a look at that face, first of all. And you'll see that if you can actually play some of this video. The video that what they're asking these kids, asking the robot, is the most creepy, and it kind of lends itself to the whole thought of the pedophilia agenda. Well, you know, and
why? Why?
Well, if you listen to it, you'll know what I mean.
You talking about the actual demo video itself?
The demo video with Alpha the robot, yeah, they're asking, well, I'll just get through it so you don't have to play it. They're asking the robot if he likes little boys, and then he says no, and then the operator asks the robot if he likes little girls, and he says no. He goes, well, do you like, I'm not sure if he said men or women first, but he did say he likes women, and then there's a dialogue back and forth as they say, as he finally agrees that he likes blonde-haired women. And there's a woman talking to him, asking him if he likes brunettes. And he says, she'll do.
Oh, good. That's not cool.
And essentially, it's one of these things that really kind of hones in on, like, modern day of, like, how they perceive men to perceive women. You know, and in all aspects, it's like, well, why would you ask this robot if you like little boys and little girls?
How old is this thing?
It's supposed to be 2 years old.
Okay. I don't think so. The way that he was standing there, the gyroscopics in that robot, they're not. I don't see anything even close to that. I mean, looking at toys for years for the kids.
Look at that.
Look at that.
I'm not sure what you guys are seeing, but I got to take a look at what you guys are looking at.
He's doing kung fu kicks. He's doing like karate kicks.
Yeah, there's no way.
Oh, no. You guys, that's not it. No, guys. Hey, no, that's, don't. You guys are looking at some weird robot. That's not it. This is much creepier. No.
Oh, it's creepier than this.
No, that's not it. That's not it.
Okay, let's see.
What's it called?
This topic is getting really weird.
It's Alpha. It's
oh my gosh! I think it's four down, Brian. The creepy one looks like it's four down. five amazing social robots that can become part of your family. That's got to be what he's talking about.
No.
No, it's the same thing. Oh, that?
No. No, not it.
Good That's now. Not it. That's Jibbo.
Welcome home.
No.
Which one?
Okay. Well, here. Let me find out exactly where this is. Continue without me here, and I'll go ahead and I'll tell you exactly where to find it. I'm gonna mute myself, and then I'll give you a reference, Brian. So
okay, thanks.
I'll be right back. Continue on, talk about whatever kind of stuff you want, and I'll give you a reference so you exactly.
Okay.
So you know exactly what I'm talking about.
Actually, let me know. I'll share with everyone. Thanks.
Yeah. Continue on. Hey guys, carry on for just a bit. I'll be right back, and we'll give you the reference so you can see exactly what I'm telling you.
Well,
I found some disheartening thing is not anything related, but I was going along the lines of the futuristic point of view that we're taking, and our history being manipulated. So I went the other way, and I looked in at the map. Remember, Harold, I was talking about maps in the future.
Yeah. Uh-huh. Okay,
so what I did is I sent a copy of the map to Brian and the group chat there.
Yeah.
And it shows the United States. And I've looked at several maps, but this one was pretty clear cut. And you could see, Corey, where are you in Canada, by the way? Is Corey with us still?
Yeah, I am. I'm about to leave because my dog is like, being a pain in the ass. Like, I'm not going to leave the chat,
but where are you in Canada?
Like 5 minutes. I'm in New Brunswick. Like, I'm about, like, the bridge across near Quebec is, like, about 5 minutes away.
Gotcha. Yeah. New Brunswick.
Is this the one where the
guys?
Is this the one where all the major lakes are run together and it's going down the middle of the country?
Yeah, Laszlo had a video about the Great Lakes and stuff. So I don't know if you guys seen that, but it changed like around Michigan, I guess. So
well, this is supposed to be
over and over again.
This is supposed to be in the future.
Yeah, a futuristic type thing.
Yeah,
and it's pretty much go. You said New Brunswick.
Yeah.
And I'm looking to see because it looks like I was tying it in where everybody lives. And
I live in Pennsylvania.
Yeah, I know that.
Ty.
Yes, I'm still.
Where do you live,
guys? I hate to intercede here.
Go ahead, please.
We have a caller that's been waiting for 7 minutes.
Okay. Yes. Go ahead, please.
Go ahead. Go.
Hey, Glow. She's got some wonderful MEs to share with us. Glow, go ahead. You got the floor.
Really bad plan. Okay. Do you hear me?
Yes. Can you guys hear her?
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. This is like a lag.
It's a little bit of a lag. Yes. Sorry for that.
Okay. So Ty is talking. So.
Yeah, go ahead.
Okay. I have a question. Okay, I have to shut this off because
you might have to mute the other side. I know it's weird.
Yeah.
Right, I have a question. Who is Kenny Shoe Stores?
Kenny who?
Kenny Shoe Stores.
Kenny Shoe Stores.
Kenny Shoe Stores.
Oh, Kenny! You mean like the little dog? You mean Kenny?
And why Kenny Shoe Stores? Kenny Shoes.
Yeah, who owns it?
I couldn't.
Kenny.
Yeah, I remember that. I'm trying to think of who did. I remember that though.
Okay. Now it's KINNY. There was never a Kenny Shoe Store. Now, as a kid,
what?
Kenny Shoe Store. Yes. Kenny.
Now it's Kenny?
Yeah. It's not Kenny Shoe Store anymore.
That makes no sense. It makes it almost sound more, a little bit more on the feminine side. Not to say anything bad, but it's Kenny.
It blew my mind. I was like, I don't know what made me look it up. I was like, was looking up shoe stores from, like, you know, when I was younger, because I was looking at Buster Brown, and I noticed that Buster Brown was completely
wrong. I loved Buster Brown when I was a kid.
Yeah.
Me too. Me too. That little dog and the little boy. Yeah, of course. I know exactly what you're talking about.
I had hush puppies.
Me too. I used to have them too. We were very poor, and I was so happy to actually have one of those because I saw the picture, and I was so excited to have one.
Yeah.
But, you know, hey, listen, honey. Look, can I tell...
The Buster Brown outfit?
Yes. First of all, his dog is really, really creepy looking. He's creepy looking, but his outfit is completely off.
I gotta see this. I gotta share it with you guys.
Buster Brown.
Yeah. Go ahead.
You know, and I'll tell you, honey, hey, listen, don't get too worried or frantic about this because we've all been there bug-eyed about a lot of different things, and there's a lot of things that will stir us up. You found the right place. I'm telling you, we're a community, and everyone out there that's listening to this, that's feeling frantic and panicked and fearful. Well, guess what? We are your real family. Guess what? The people that you know that aren't getting you, that aren't understanding what's going on, we are your family. We are your real family, guys.
Look at that. Look at that.
That's kind of creepy.
So, I'm glad that you found us, and I'm so happy that we're all together. So don't feel panic about these things. You know, these are just, and might I point out to everyone here too, these little anomalies of you may see little shoe things like that. You may see little dots that are missing or apostrophes missing and all that. That's not what this is about, guys. This is simply just telling every one of you guys that something is happening is all it's doing. And now we're together, so stick together.
I had those shoes. See the blue ones? I had those.
He's on crack. That dog never looked like that. And Buster Brown was always...
You know what he looks like? He looks like the Cheshire Cat.
I don't even see what's
going on. He kind of does, yeah.
He's really creepy.
Look at that. Look at how creepy he looks.
He never looked like that.
He was wow, like this face looks weird, huh?
Yeah.
Wow, that's
who's the little girl?
What color was his hat? Do you remember Buster Brown?
Blue, wasn't it?
Was it blue?
It was blue, wasn't it?
Blue.
Yeah, it's red here.
It's showing up red now.
Yeah, it was white and blue because he was dressed nautical.
Yeah, he was dressed like an old time sailor.
Sailor. Like exactly.
Yeah.
And
that's
I remember his dog did not look demonic like that. I'm sorry. That's creepy.
Gosh. Yeah.
Didn't his dog had a head? Am I thinking the wrong one, or is this the dog with the thing around one eye?
It should have been one like
Rascals.
Like the Rascals, yeah.
Yeah.
Oh, it had that too. It had it did have that. It had that little not the round like circle around it, but it had the dark eye.
Yeah.
For sure it did.
Yeah, that was Petey. Now, Buster Brown's dog was always, like, cute. Didn't look like... That's really scary, and he looked scary, too. But he had a nautical outfit on. That's a fact. I know that.
Yeah, you're right. You're absolutely correct.
The Kenny Shoe Store is a big one for me, because I remember Kenny Shoes. Now it's Kenny, which, to me, doesn't make any sense. Does anybody remember... In 1975, they won the global cooling...
What was it?
Global cooling. Yeah, have you ever heard of that?
I do, yeah.
Yes, I did. Yeah, I did, yep.
Of sure. course.
I have never heard of it. Was always global warming. Don't use that as a global
cooling. No, I've heard of global cooling, yeah. It didn't work out, so they switched it to global warming.
Correct.
And that didn't work out.
And I remember that didn't work out either.
So now they're back to global cooling and possible what is called the temperature variance.
Well, let me tell you, nobody
went for the global cooling because they didn't buy this.
Let me tell you guys something that I can interject here. You know, I could tell you something that I saw on the news. This is on the mainstream, of course, but it was back when it wasn't so conspiratorialized, I guess. This is something where they were saying that there was a humongous asteroid heading our way, and it was destined to impact us, and it was absolutely a fearful moment. And then there was no talk about it after that.
What asteroid?
It was a there was supposed to be, I don't know exactly what the name of it was, but it was on the mainstream media saying there's a gigantic asteroid. Hold on, guys. There's a gigantic asteroid heading our way, and then there was nothing. There was no talk about it. It went silent. It went absolutely silent. No one said anything after that. I'm like, what the hell are you going to say? There's a huge asteroid and there's nobody talking about it? Right. Are you kidding me?
It had a number. It didn't even have a name. It had a number.
Yeah.
That's why I can't remember the name.
So, right. It's always a number, guys. And so, listen, so this particular thing that you know, what I'm theorizing is, listen, you know, and there's a ton of them. So you can take this as what you will, but I'm thinking, I mean, look, I'm certain that we're in the unveiling. I know that for a fact. I know that nothing in the world, it doesn't matter if it's CERN or, you know, D-Wave or what some of the other things that are out there. Nothing could change my body sculpture. Okay, listen, you know, they can't change where my heart is. They can't change how many ribs I have. They can't put the bones in the back of my eyes. They can't change my skull or, you know, where my kidneys are, you know, among a few of the millions of things that are going on in the world, like the Lindbergh baby and all that things. But let's just stick with the body functions. Okay, so the moment they start changing my body, it tells me that my consciousness has actually shifted into an entirely different body. And now where am I? Okay, so now I got to deal with this whole fake crap. Okay, so now I don't know if that whole big planet thing, the asteroid they're talking about, was real. But I'm thinking...
Fake news.
Could be fake news, but the fact is that how the hell did I get here? How did I get here when I know that my body used to look a certain way? Now, let me tell you. Let me give you a little background of who I am. I'm an artist. I'm a very... You know, I'm not like Picasso by any means, but I've done things on a global scale. I mean, I've created, you know, giant dancing inflatables and all that, and murals all across the world. I know art. I study art. I love art. I know all kinds of things about art, and you know, and I've done life, you know, studies. But okay, that's just art. Now, my original major was anthropology. So I know a lot about the body, the cultures, and the study of like history, where we came from. I love knowing where I'm from. And guess what? All these things aren't adding up. Okay, so I know that my body, and to boot, very spiritual as well. I shouldn't say back then I wasn't very spiritual. Let me digress. You know, I went to catechism and all that. I studied. I was a Catholic, became a Christian. So, you know, I was kind of like in the school like anyone else. I'm like, oh, this is boring. This sucks. I don't really want to be here. But, you know, I still retained a lot of stuff, you know. But the fact of the matter is that I did, you know, I can't be 100% on like all the things that are out there. So if I don't understand, I will tell you that I don't understand. I don't get it or I don't know. I just simply don't know. And I'll be honest with you guys. But if I know something, you know, if I can solidify this thing, I can tell you this for certain. I am not the same guy that I was when I studied all this stuff, because I studied it intensively. And I love knowing where I'm from, guys. I do. I love knowing like cultures and things like that. I know a little bit about a lot of different things. And I can tell you, my body was not the way it is now.
You have a great memory for this stuff. You're fantastic at it, man. Like the Hindenburg discovery. That was insane.
Well, that's not old, Brian, and that's great. Boy, but you know what?
Glo has a question.
Right now, Brian, is that Troy?
Yeah, that's Troy.
Yeah, it is. It's me.
Can I ask him a question?
Yeah, go ahead. He's right here.
Let me ask a question. You know who?
Wait, who?
Edgar Cayce.
Edgar Cayce, yes.
Okay, Edgar Cayce, I know who you're talking about. You know, kind of like the equivalent of your Nostradamus, I guess.
Right, basically. Do you know anything about the history? I know anything about his life.
Yes,
I know a lot about Edgar Cayce. Sure.
I'm kin to him, sure. So yeah, I do.
I've read just about every one of his books. I love his stuff. Okay, I've studied him for years. I've watched documentaries on him over and over again. Recently I went online and I said, you know what, let me watch it again. I haven't watched it in like 2 years. His life story completely changed.
Really?
Floyd.
No
it
way.
Hang on, is that Emmy?
Oh, you're gonna get me. You're gonna get me into a whole different tangent now. Now I got a whole different direction that I have to study now. Thanks, appreciate that, but I certainly will. Absolutely.
Let me explain.
Go ahead, Glo.
From what I remember, okay, Edgar Cayce was kind of illiterate. Okay, he was kind of quiet. He was illiterate. He lived on a farm with his wife. Okay, and he really didn't do much. They didn't have much money. And then he started doing all this prophesying and stuff like that. And he would do it in his barn. And he would do readings. And he wouldn't take money for it. And the guy and his family, they had no money, but he refused to take money for it. So people would bring him things. They would give him food. They would exchange things for readings. And that's what he did. And when he died, they saved that bed that he used to lay down on to go into a meditated state. And it was in his barn. That's where he did it. Always until the day he died. His story completely changed. I watched it the other day. He was loaded. He was very smart. He worked for a printing company. Then he opened up his own business. I said, wait a minute, that never happened. He was illiterate. That was the whole big thing about Edgar Cayce, because when he went into trance, he would speak so well and words that he never used. I mean, it just blew my mind. If anybody knows anything about Edgar Cayce, look at the documentary.
Yeah, I heard he was.
Look at his life.
I heard he was good at memorizing the Bible.
Yes, he was. That's what he did. He studied the Bible. He was a Bible man, but he was a farmer, and he was an illiterate farmer. That's what he didn't. He didn't speak much. And I remember they say he was like really not educated at all. Like when they would speak to him, but he knew the Bible back and forth.
Whoa, that is amazing. That is so amazing. I think. We need to watch his story.
Yeah.
Well, Edgar Cayce was known as the sleeping.
Yeah, Brian. Prophet.
Yeah, Harold. Yeah, Brian. What are you saying about your relative or Archie?
Yeah, he's kin to me. Yeah, he's about 4 generations back. He was kin to me through my father's side. Yeah, it was his wife. My father's. We were kin to his wife, basically. And he was called the Sleeping Prophet. He opened a hospital, which was based on his readings. And the hospital didn't do well at all. It ended up folding. It didn't do anything. But he opened it up, and he wanted to give people free healings, basically.
Right.
And the problem was people started taking advantage of him, and he would go to sleep. People would sneak in and start asking him questions, you know, who's going to win this? Who's going to do that? You know, what about this stock? What about that stock? And he got so mad he quit giving readings because he didn't want to have his talent misused, basically.
I can't tell you how much I studied Edgar Cayce. I do. It's just, it's a completely different story. It really is. I know him. I don't know. You just have to watch it. It was mine, but it was the same thing. You know, the other day I went online, I watched Elvis Presley's life story. I don't remember Elvis Presley dying from heart disease and he was bedridden and had nurses taking care of him the last few months of his life. He played in concert right up until he died.
He died on the toilet.
Right. But this is what you have to understand. I remember Priscilla Presley, when they did a documentary on him, she turned around, she said that Elvis was with his right-hand man. I can't remember his name. Okay, Tony, Anthony, I don't remember.
Colonel something.
Wait a minute. Are you talking about Elvis or Edgar Cayce here?
Elvis.
Now in this day and age, I don't think he died on a toilet anymore. I think that's incorrect.
Elvis. Drugs, got up, because Priscilla Presley was telling the story. He got up and went into the bathroom, and that's where he died. He died in the bathroom of an overdose.
He did. In my reality, he died there too, honey. But yeah. I think in this day and age, I think that's wrong now. I think that that's been corrected. I don't think he's died on a toilet now. I think it's something else. I seem to recall something else actually happened to him.
he died in the bathroom, regardless whether he was on the toilet or not. That's not the point. The point is, right. He did not die from drugs. They found no drugs in his system. He died of heart disease, and he died at the age of 42, which everybody said was so weird because his mother died at the age of 42. If you look it up now, it says, no, people made a mistake. Elvis's mother died at 46. No, she didn't. She died the same age as his mother. Okay, and now his mother died at 46, and Elvis died at 42 with no drugs.
Honey, you sound like all of us when we're realizing that something is not the case, and you're right. You're absolutely right. I understand your intensity on this, and you're right. You know, and the thing that we can all grasp is that we understand things as one way. But we all can't understand things the same exact way because we're all not from the same exact timeline. And we may understand things, the same things in all directions, but we're not all going to understand things the same exact way all the way down the line. And that's the truth. And I don't know how to explain it, but that's just the way it is.
Troy, Glow wanted to ask you, how do you remember Elvis Presley dying? I don't know. I wasn't around back then.
Well, Elvis Presley was certainly, you know, okay, if, let me answer this. I remember the way that most everyone else does, he died on the toilet. That was an embarrassing moment for him. But if you look now in this timeline, from what I last looked up, and who knows how it is now, because certainly things do flip-flop, you know, he did not die like that, no. I haven't looked recently, but it was not as embarrassing as it is depicted. So I haven't looked at it recently.
He didn't. I don't remember. I remember Elvis doing concerts until right up until he did die, and he was like 280 pounds. Okay, something like that. They said now he was bedridden. He had nurses with him around the clock for months and months while he was dying. We would have heard of this. We would have heard about him on his deathbed.
And it's just like this. Listen, let me break off from that subject really quick. Okay. How does everyone remember Bruce Lee dying? Okay, the most people remember him being shot. That's the whole thing. Is that, you know, he had a very similar death the way his son did. They were both shot. In making a movie. And now, if you look back at the history of Bruce Lee did not die from being shot. So if now recently, like, you know, awakening to this whole thing, you're gonna be shocked because Bruce Lee actually died from adverse effects to medication. So if you didn't know that, well, guess what? You might want to look it up because that's the new truth.
Well, and now
he died by being shot.
Yeah, I know. And now they're calling
he was shot.
They're calling this somewhat of an Alice in Wonderland effect. I've been looking up that a little bit more, but
yes, you're right.
It's nothing like the Mandela effect.
Hold on, I'll break away for a second.
They're calling it a mental health problem.
Somebody did a video about a year ago, and they said that the Mandela effect was now called Alice in Wonderland effect. And it's kind of weird because somebody did a video the other day. I can't remember her name. She does excellent videos on the Mandela effect. And
the greatest of these is love. That was George Ann, I think.
Yeah, and it's like now is a completely different thing. Where a year ago, if you looked up what's the Mandela effect, it was called Alice in Wonderland. It was a mental disorder. And I'm like, wait a minute, that's really weird because I remember somebody did a video on that and now it's something else. It's, I don't know what she was saying about seeing weird. And I said, no, that's what they called the Mandela effect a year ago. So that Gina kind of changed. I don't know if anybody else seen the video. You know, Brian, can you pull up a photo of the chocolate Rolos?
Yeah, I'm trying to remember if it was. I used to eat those things all the time.
I remember Rolos. I remember Apostrophe S. I don't remember Rolo. I remember Rolos.
Well, I'm having the same issue with Hershey and Hershey's, guys. I remember Hershey. I remember Hershey Bar, not Hershey's Bar.
No, I remember Hershey. Wait, Hershey's?
It's now Hershey's Bar.
No, did something really weird with the S is coming off, and
I think it's really weird. It has to do with possession, I think, because that's what do you think S's represent? Apostrophe S has to do with possession in the English language.
Well, I think it has to. I think it means singular. I mean, like a singular
or singularity kind of thing. Singularity.
Right, yeah. Now look at the roll. This doesn't look right.
Oh.
It was a question.
What do you guys remember?
Everything is completely wrong.
Rolos.
Was it Rolos or Rolo?
Rolos.
Yeah, that doesn't make any sense, Rolo.
No, everybody I know remembers Rolos, and I'm like, yeah, I mean, we all eat it. It was, well, and I found residue, actually. I have it on my computer. I found residue for Rolos. So.
Cool.
Yeah, it doesn't make any sense, Rolo. That, no. I don't know. It's hurting my head now.
Yeah, me too.
It doesn't look right. It doesn't look right on the roll. But anyway, history is completely changing. And if you go back and watch, like, I watched documentaries on I Love Lucy and how she got divorced and, you know, how her husband used to beat her and all this stuff. It's completely different. Completely different story.
Well, his name used to be Desi Arnaz, and now it's Arnaz.
Right. Yeah, and when she was married to him, I remember he wasn't so nice to her.
Well, guess what, Ricky? You got a lot of explaining to do.
He was sleeping around on her. He was basically sleeping around with all these women.
Of course he was. Yeah, of course he was.
And when he died penniless. He was completely broke.
Yeah. He had a really good situation. He wanted to be a playboy. You know, he wanted to be the guy that, you know, had all the women. He neglected some of the things that were really important to him, like family. Because he really did have a little kid with her. You know,
yeah,
and that was the
two kids.
Right, exactly. So, I mean, he really blew a good thing. She was a powerful woman in the industry. And I'm not sure about the whole underlying factor of, like, if she was there simply to destroy him, which I'm sure she had the power to do that because she was so iconic and that's what the whole show was all about. But the point is that, look, that's not, you know, things in this timeline have certainly changed and have restructured the way that things are now. Like, simply not just his name, but look, if you look back at, like, Lucy, you got a lot of explaining to do. Guess what? Does not exist. Never said that.
Yeah.
Never said it.
You know what, Troy? You know what? The other day I was talking to my girlfriend and I was like, oh, you know, I wonder if the groundhog is going to see its shadow. Do you know that changed too?
The groundhog
sees its shadow. What does it mean, guys?
It means
six months or weeks? I don't know exactly. But
I think it's weeks.
Of cold or whatever it was. Yeah, I remember Groundhog Day, and I love that show. Oh my God, the movie was great.
Wait, what do you remember? Guys, let her speak, please.
And my girlfriend remembers, and we're all Mandela affected. Now, I remember if the groundhog sees its shadow, that means it's in 6 weeks it'll be spring. It doesn't mean that anymore.
What does it mean?
If it would see its shadow, meant that spring was right around the corner.
What?
Right around the corner. And if it didn't see its shadow, then...
Look that up, Brian. Brian, look that up. I got to see that right now. That doesn't make any sense. I'm getting obliterated with all these things that are going on now. If you're telling me the truth right now, hon, I hope you're not just messing with me, because I'm seeing some things that are really I get some things, you know, are anomalies, you know, that, you know, a lot of things resonate with me and I get it that they're not so, you know, important, but this is kind of like a big thing. Of having, like, you know, factual data, I guess. They do this all the time. This is like Punxsutawney thing. This is all over the news. This is like not like a small thing.
I have a Bill Murray scene in my head whenever I think of that. But
Punxsutawney Phil, right? And so this is like a big thing. I thought it was just like a made up thing, you know, originally, and I've come to find out that it's actually a real thing. That if it really does happen, that's really what it is. That's kind of the whole premise of why they made the movie. And now you're telling me that the whole movie doesn't even make any sense?
No, look. It says, emerging from its burrow on this day, sees a shadow due to clear weather, will retreat to its den, and winter will persist for six more weeks.
Yeah, there it is.
That's true.
No, that's right.
If he sees its shadow, that means spring was right around the corner. We were all, oh, did he see a shadow? My girlfriend's like, yeah, like, yay, summer. It was never like that. That doesn't make sense.
Well, if he sees his shadow, it's going to be
six more weeks of winter.
Six more weeks of winter. If he does not see
it.
Spring comes early if he doesn't see a shadow. That's what I remember.
No, it was the opposite. It was we remember the opposite. We remember if he's seen a shadow, it was spring. Spring was right around the corner. If he didn't, we were like,
What you're saying is that if he sees a shadow, that means that spring will be there soon.
Yeah.
Right.
Now that's odd because you know that's not unheard of. Seeing different timelines that actually have different memories. So what you're thinking right now, honey, is not unheard of. I've seen these and heard these things, and it may not resonate with everyone, but you know what?
Right.
I've seen so many different variations. It doesn't mean it's not true. It's just what you experience and what you remember. And now, you know, who's to say that you're wrong or right? Because, you know, we're not in that particular timeline that you are, but you know what? I've also
weird because it's not something that happened once and you remember as a child. This happens every
Correct. And you know, and I've known people that think that there's 52 states and there's not, you know, and we're already in 5G, which by the way, we're going into 5G right now. So, you know, there's so many different things that resonate that you guys may be experiencing. And again, let me tell you guys, if you guys are listening in just to understand, I appreciate that. If you're here to troll us, you know, because of what we believe, you guys are getting it all wrong. You don't understand exactly what it feels like to be experiencing something that let me put it to you like this. Now, imagine one day you wake up and you think that everything's normal, but then little things, they're not so apparent, but little things start to emerge where you think that, they're just little flukes here and there. And then you realize that, you know, they're like little symbols that are telling you, hey, pay attention to the bigger picture. You pull open your Bible and then you find out that things in the Bible have actually directly changed, that are trying to change the direction of your own belief that you've known. Now, if you're not spiritual, I get it. Now, let's take that in a different direction to a much more relevant and resonating fact. Take a look at your map. Look at your map. If the map that you're looking at right now or going to makes sense to you, then don't worry about it. You've picked the wrong channel. Move on, and you're good. But you've always known it's like, you know, Santa Claus. I mean, you love Santa Claus. Come on, who doesn't? But you know what? Santa Claus lived in the North Pole, right? There was always an Arctic cap at the top of every globe and every map. Okay, so if this is not resonating with you, then you're not going to get it too. But there was always an Arctic, like, you know, mass, and now it's not there any longer. And if you can find it, you can go ahead, you can hit me up and tell me, show me. And I guarantee you, anyone that's listening to this, I will put $1,000, $1,000 cash. I'm putting this out on broadcast. $1,000. I will pay you if you can find me an actual cartographer, an actual legitimate map that actually has the North Pole without Greenland. Greenland is not the Arctic, by the way. You know, an actual map. I'll pay you out $1,000. I'll put it on broadcast and I'll send it to you live in front of all these people so you know that it's legitimate. You find me that and I will pay you. I promise you.
But see, in a way, it's good that we do have trolls, because if you think about it, they're probably just really curious. And no matter what, you know, what they say, any kind of negative things, I mean, they're still checking out the channel and they're still curious. So maybe they'll open up their eyes. You know,
haters are going to hate. Haters are going to hate anyway. But it's okay. I think you're right. I think they are curious. Either that,
start pointing
attention.
And you see, Brian, you know, you start pointing out the most basic of facts that everyone should know, like the North Pole, and then guess what? They start going the other way because you can't run away from something that we've always known.
Sorry, Glow, what were you saying?
Just saying nobody was affected, like none of us were affected, and we were watching somebody else's channel that was affected. Wouldn't you at least go, wow, this is really interesting. Who are these people? And why are they saying these things? And I need to look into this and find out how come I'm not experiencing it. Even if you were an actor that said, oh my God, you know, this Mandela thing, people saying I died, I want to talk to them. I want to know, how was I, you know, in a different life, and how did I die? Wouldn't it be some curiosity? And I just think it's kind of strange that you have all these stars that, you know, in this timeline are dying again and songs that are changing. And nobody steps forward and says, hey, how did I die in a prior life that you remember? And, you know, like, nobody's curious. It just makes you think like they're all bots. It's just weird. Because I know me, myself, I would take an interest in it. Even if I wasn't Mandela affected, I would take an interest on those that were. I would be fascinated by it. Like, tell me more. You know, like, how was I? You know what I'm saying? And the fact that a lot of these people don't come forward and say, well, how did I die and what kind of person was I? That's kind of weird, don't you think?
Yeah, I do.
They're not curious.
I think it takes a certain degree of like thinking level, you know, because not everybody's on the same thinking level we're at, obviously. And I mean, you can only lead a horse to water, but you can't make him drink. You know what I'm saying? That's my thing.
Listen,
guys, I have had my boss of one of my jobs come up to me and they took me to lunch. And my boss brings up, if you build it, they will come. How many times do you think I got tempted to say something about the Mandela effect? But I can't bring it up to bosses or anything like that.
No, you cannot, because the moment you bring anything like this up to anything that's going to jeopardize your life, that's exactly what they want you to do. They're leading you to this point where you're going to jeopardize your whole entire integrity and live in pain and fear. We are all going through that same exact thing. Well, I can't say all of us because, you know, some of us are, who knows? I can't speak for anyone, but I will speak for me. My entire life has been completely rearranged because of this whole entire anomaly. You know, I've lost family. I mean, everyone I've known throughout my entire upbringing has changed. You know, this is not something that's like, you know, just a little, you know, oh, you know, I you know, there's things going on and, you know, I'm just going to move on. It's not like that. You know, I didn't know why all these things were happening to me.
Jesus, okay? Jesus was here and he knew everything about life and how it worked and where we came from and who we're from and every answer, right, to every question that they did to him. And now, and he was one person who knew the truth, and look what they did to him. Now there's thousands of us that know the truth. Thousands. What are we going to do with what we know? It's time to do something, because we've been in this.
I'm glad you mentioned that, because guess what? We all don't know that, but you know what? We have a pretty good idea that we're all together and we are a true family. Guess what? It doesn't matter who you lost. This is my family. You guys are my family. And guess what? You know, I'm under the belief that, you know, there is something big going on right now. You know, maybe there's a war in heaven. I've already pledged myself to enlist in this battle of heaven. I don't know if I could battle some kind of demon, but I'd truly do it right now. I promise you, I'd rather be out of this kind of hellhole than experience, you know, what I've been going through, you know, for the last, what, 5+ years. I mean, yeah. I didn't know it at the point in time because I got it back, you know, back in October of last year. So I'm a newbie. But I knew that there were things going on. I mean, I've seen it. Look, you know, I think one of the first things that really, truly resonated with me when I was visiting my folks, which I already had an estranged relationship with, trying to resolve, you know, some really, you know, bad upbringing. And I just kept on, you know, I'm that guy that just says, hey, you know, I'll give everyone a chance and I'll give them a chance again. And I'll just keep on giving them a chance because that's the kind of person I am. And, you know, I mean, at my own detriment. You know, but I won't sacrifice my kid. I'll, you know, I'm one of those guys that says, you know, hey, I want my son to meet his grandparents. I'm not going to be like the folks that I had that I never had a chance to meet my grandfather. You know, only time I ever saw my grandfather was when my mother and father took a picture of him in his casket, and guess what? Now I know exactly how I'm going to look when I die, you know, because he was exact spitting image of me, but my mother hated him so much, but, you know, I never had a chance to even know him, and I'm not going to deny my son to at least make some kind of, you know, connection with them. As long as they don't hurt him, you know, or do anything bad, hey, I'm going to give him the opportunity to make his own decisions. The fact of the matter is that, look, I want everyone here that's listening to know that, you know, if you bring this up in any kind of public forum, you're going to get, feedback from it. You're going to get it. I promise you, if you don't know what I'm talking about, just mention it. You'll see what I mean. And don't do it. And I'll give you a warning. I'll give you a warning. Don't do it in anything that could personally jeopardize you. You don't do it in any form that it could jeopardize your job, because you will lose it. I promise you, you start mentioning it to anyone that you love, that, like, personally, like, you really love, like, your family members, guess what? You're going to have some kind of feedback. I promise you, you might end up losing your relationship, your entire, like, you know, everything you knew, because they're not seeing it, and they're going to call you a freak, and they probably think that you need some psychological help. But guess what? You know your own truth, and you're going to see this. This is a constant running theme, guys. This is not something that I'm just making up, that we are making up. This is not a fad. This is something that's genuinely happening. And it's scary as hell. And you know what? You guys are my family. And you know what? I'm here for you. If you don't understand how intense this could be,
I know,
well, guess what?
You know, they say ignorance is bliss sometimes. But how can you ignore the fact that our world is changing?
Yeah, exactly.
Time is being sucked away from us.
You can accept it, and who knows what the consequences are, but we know.
Here's the question. What are we supposed to be doing with it? Is this just for us to wake up so something better is coming? Are we supposed to do something with it?
Good question. I think you are supposed to be talking about it, and I think you are supposed to be saying something, and I don't know why or you know, because you're going to get a lot of flack from it.
I feel that there's something coming, and there's really not much that we have to do. We just have to be awake and stay awake. But there's something.
You have to choose your audience. You can drop breadcrumbs, but you don't want to go ahead and start being crazy, like, you know, announcing this in forums where it's going to be to your detriment. I mean, listen, you got to choose your audience very wisely. And, you know, for the people that you know, if you think you know somebody really well in this day and age that you could talk to about this, oh boy, I would say you really want to rethink that. If you really want to have that kind of relationship that you really think that you can have, I would be very, very careful. You know, just, I would say just drop breadcrumbs and find out, because you may find out that the person that you know is not really who you know. Now, I'm going to go out on a limb and say that relationship is done.
I mean, you think about that's kind of scary. The same person that you're with is not the same person anymore.
Well, it's not. That's creepy. I think if there is such thing as a multiple.
Watch. I don't want to test this with you guys, but simply drop a breadcrumb and say, what do you think about this?
You know,
and you'll see what I mean. It can end you up in a whole different dynamic, and the person that you think you know, the entire demeanor will change. I promise you. And I'm just saying this because I've already experienced this on numerous times, not just one or two or three or a thousand. I can't say a thousand, but, you know, a lot. You know, every person I've told, they're afraid to talk about this, and there's no rationale for it.
Troy, what if, okay, there's another frequency, another Earth, okay, and we reside in that frequency, that Earth, right, that timeline. I think, and the same people are in our lives. I think where our consciousness resides, which is this timeline, the people that don't get it, they're just bots. But in a different timeline, that's where their consciousness resides. Does that make sense?
It does. In fact, I've actually thought about this concept quite a few times. You know, I'm thinking about the other person that's me, like, hanging out with somebody else right now. You know, and what kind of dickhead this guy is, because he left me in one real shithole of a time. And I mean this in the best of sincere ways, but the guy that was here before me was kind of a real dick. And you know, and I've already experienced a lot of stuff, and I've actually pointed this out. And I don't mean to be a bit against the Christian ways, but I'm just being candid, okay? So, you know, let me speak freely, if you will. And I mean this because I believe in God. And I don't mean to be like so harsh and things, but you guys, you have to understand, the person that I am now is not the person that I've actually been elected to be right now. So I have a lot of like, you know, I got to reach out and be the best person I possibly can to possibly, you know, salvage some of the relationships that apparently I've dissolved. And by me doing this, you know, I've got to, you know, I've got to navigate my way down these corridors that are so unnavigable, if that is even a word, you know, and I got to figure out how to solve these issues that I was never even in, as far as I'm concerned. And I gotta, you know, make all my reparations or make them understand that this person that you see here in a certain sense, it's not that person that actually did these things. So, Ryan? I mean, it's the most complicated thing. It's a maze, you know, that I've got to navigate down and then try to decide, you know, make it so it's I'm not alienating myself at the same time where I sound like a lunatic.
Brian?
Because I'm not.
Can you check what I wrote on the thing?
Messenger?
Yeah, no, go over. Just go back one and check.
Where at?
In Hangouts, but you know, on the thing where, you know.
Wait a second. You know what I mean? Are we having a secretive conversation? I don't know.
No. It's not.
No, did you send me some?
Yeah, well, I'm here. Yeah, I'm here in the message. It's a Hangouts message.
All right, on Mandela or Brian?
Clip back one.
I didn't know who that went to. I thought it was to Brian, but I just got a call
from
a friend that he was going through a hard time and he was kind of like suicidal, and I had to deal with that. So
Corey, no problem, brother. Hey, listen.
Hey, man, anytime.
You know, hey, Brian.
You know, yeah. Listen. You break away. That is much more of a priority than going ahead and having anything, dude. You listen. You break away at a moment's notice. You're good. You're good, man. Don't even worry about that. Don't sweat that. You and for the caller, you know, I didn't catch your name. I'm sorry, but you know, let me tell you, honey. You know, I'm so glad that you called in and you have these concerns. Whoa. You know, and I'm so glad that we can, you know, that you're reaching out, because, you know, this is the first step to actually understanding that you actually do have a true bond with people that are going through the same exact things that you are. And you don't have to be afraid now. You know, it's going to get a lot easier. And some of the things that you're going to notice, like, you know, all over are not going to be so intense. You know, we're all eyes wide and we're all bug-eyed and we're freaking out, and I get it. You know, you're going to see a lot more along the way, and something.
I'm not afraid of it. I've been experiencing this for a good 12 years. I'm not afraid of it. I just didn't have a name for it. I didn't know what it was, but I've been seeing.
Okay.
Mandela effects.
Well, honey, anyway. Listen, if you want to talk to me personally, you know, we can have some, you know, some side dialogue, and I'd be more than happy to talk with you about a lot of the things that you're going through personally. You know, I'll make myself available for that, because, you know, I think that's certainly necessary if you feel the need, of course.
Corey, let me ask you something, if it's okay.
Sure.
If somebody were to come up to you 10 years ago to tell you about the Mandela effect, would you have thought they were crazy?
Yes.
Really?
Yes.
Absolutely. Me too.
Like.
I remember in 2009, I drove my son to Staples, and I remember sitting outside Staples and going, "Wow, when did they change that logo? That's kind of weird." And that was in 2009. And the same thing with subways. And then the same thing with the 52 states. Me and my son had a huge argument. I was like, "This 52 states." We stood outside of a Walmart asking people that walked by, "How many states are there? Some said 52, some said 50." This is going.
How many do you believe?
I mean, I would have heard you out. I wouldn't have dismissed you and like been like all weird. I would have probably heard you out, and just in the back of my mind, I'm thinking, "Oh man, this person really got some issues." But you know, the thing is, I wouldn't, you know, not
not knowing what I know now, I mean, I think that's kind of the standard to think of somebody that's saying some things that are so outlandish that they can't even be rationalized. I don't blame people for thinking that I'm absolutely just off my rocker. But you know, the reality is that now in this day and age, I still know if someone's talking crazy, or at least sounding like they're crazy. But I'm more open-minded about a lot of things where I can't just say definitively this person is nuts. If I disagree with something, I think I would be, I would listen, I would, evaluate, analyze, and then probably, just let it go. If it didn't resonate with me, I guess I wouldn't really, pay it too much mind, I guess. But I mean, in this day and age, I've seen so many weird things that just don't make any sense, and they can't make any sense because they're so. I mean, this is the only thing this really could be is God. I mean, that's the only thing I'm thinking of because we are in a fairy tale right now. That's what it is. I mean, look, the fact of the matter is that I spent a great deal of my life, with all these memories and all these learning experiences that I went to school and I was a very good student, and I learned things very well. And I was, I wouldn't say I was like top of my class by any means, but I was very, very astute. I'm a very smart individual and I know things and I absorb things. And I wouldn't say that I know a lot about a lot of things. I know a little bit about a lot of things and I know them definitively because I really, I always want to make sure my facts were in check. And so if I ever mentioned something, I wouldn't want to say things that were incorrect, mainly because let me just, digress here, especially being a radio guy. And that's, if you guys don't even know my background, I'd be on the radio and I'd talking to the public, in an open forum, and I would say things that could be checked, that could be verified and validated, and I can come back and I'd have, people just bouncing things off back and forth. So if my facts weren't in order, the onslaught I would receive would be, it'd be grievous. So that being said, is that I made sure that I always knew what I was talking about because I just couldn't just openly just spout something off because we have some pretty intelligent people out there that were in, involved in the dialogue. That being said, is that the facts that I knew at one point in time for a lot of different things have changed. And the fact of the matter is that not just simply grammatical errors or logos or little points and dashes and dots and apostrophes, because that's not the point. The point is that our entire way of life and the way that we, as we know it, have completely been altered. The person that I am now is not the person that I really, really am. It's not in the body I am. Let me just point it to you like that. So I was actually like kind of zapped into a different reality.
I wonder what all these changes to the bone structure and the skull. I wonder when we're going to start to notice the changes when we look in the mirror and our faces change. Because you look at the skull is getting longer, right? The cheekbones and the jawbone. When are we going to start seeing the changes in our own faces?
You're seeing it already. I mean, as far as what they declare our skull to be. Now, see, I haven't seen that personally in my face with the exception of one thing, is that now I do have hexagonal eyes. I haven't pointed that out to anyone else. And if you haven't noticed that yourself, you may want to take a good look in the mirror because guess what? The hexagonal eyes are now kind of like the new thing. And that's one thing I can resonate with.
What I've noticed on myself, kind of trippy, is that the palm of my hands got a lot bigger and my fingers got shorter. Really bugs me out. I'm looking at my hands right now, and these are not my hands. The palms got really big, and my fingers are short. So it was always the opposite.
Huh.
That I noticed. But other than that, other than my face, I went to go see my dad yesterday, and he just says, "Wow, your face looks really thin." And I'm like, "Okay, I don't know. To me, it looks the same. So maybe we don't notice it because it's subtle, but other people notice it when they look at us. I don't know."
Possibly, but are they looking different too? I mean, because that's one thing that I was wondering. a little while back, I looked like I was getting gaunt, you know, and it's like, well, I haven't changed anything, but you know, then I realized that the cheekbones have actually narrowed quite a bit. So, you know, I figured, Mel, maybe I'm skipping a couple of meals. I'm working too hard. So I didn't really notice it. So maybe I was, you know, subconsciously I'm thinking, well, maybe I just got to beef up, you know, whatever, you know, just improve my diet a little bit better.
Yeah, but you know, kind of weird when he said that, he was like, your face is so skinny. He goes, why is your face so thin? And right. I was like, oh, to me, I look the same. You know, I'm a small person. I'm 5'3". I'm 130 pounds. I'm little, you know,
You sound distant, honey. You sound distant. I can't really hear you. I don't know if you got away from the phone or the microphone or whatever, but you might want to get a little bit closer to it.
We're fine.
Okay. I just want to take a quick second, and you can continue your topic. I just wanted to say about – I had a phone call from a friend, and it was – It was a hard phone call for me, and I just want
to
say to all you guys, if you can pray for my friend Jill, send him prayers, because like he's at a hard time right now. And
what's his name? His name is
Jill.
Jill? Okay, yeah. Let's get a little more specific. What's going on with Jill? Is he having heart issues, you say?
No, it's...
is it suicidal? Is that what it is?
Yeah.
Okay, well, we're going to go ahead, and that's more specific, and, you know, and that way we can go ahead, we can combine them in the prayers for sure. Jill's going to be okay. You know, Jill is probably going through some tough times, just like a lot of people are, and let's pull them together. We'll get to that for sure, man. You know, Jill, you know, if you're listening, I don't know if he is, but... hey, Bob, you know, we all go through some hard times. You know, we all have a tough road to hoe. You have to endure in these days. These are tough times, guys. These are not easy. But, you know, our God, our Lord, our Father, he says, look, we must endure. You know, there's going to be the paradise on the other end, but don't just give up hope. You know, I get it. I've been there. I've had those thoughts of like, man, I just want to end it all. You know, and I can't believe that I'm even thinking some of these things, but I think it's just the demon saying, just end it, you know, and, you know, I think if we do that, we've given ourselves up and we don't, you know, we're cutting ourselves short and we're kind of giving in to the bad stuff that's going on around us. So you guys that are really going through some tough times, and I get it. It's struggling. It's so hard, but you got to reach out to us, guys. Listen, we are here for you. I'm here for you. Now, I'm not going to speak for anyone else, but for me, look, guys, I've been through some tough times, and I'll share my story with you guys at a later date, but, you know, listen, you know, I've been through some really tough times. I promise you, I've really been through I've been through the mill. I've been emancipated at 15, and I went through some really tough times as a kid, and I really had to make my own, and I had a good time, and I'm humble right now, guys. You know, don't give up on you know, life, because things are going rough right now.
Yes.
You know, it's going to be okay. You'll land on your feet, and I'll help you out if whatever I can, okay?
So
hang in there, guys.
Does this person want to commit suicide because of the Mandela effect or because of personal reasons?
No, like, he doesn't even know about Emmy. It was somebody... Like, I'm a counselor, and he reached out to me because I asked him to, and he just called me, like, late tonight, and he was crying, and he was in a bad place, and right when all this was going on, right, and I didn't know what to tell him. I told him that, basically, you know, go see your mom at home, they had hard times and stuff, but she's here, his mom, and she'll
Hey, Corey, do me a favor, man. Give this guy my number. Say, hey, talk to this guy. You know, I could, you know, at least, you know, chat with the guy for a little bit. You know, I think that, you know, he and I will have a great conversation. Maybe I can, you know, I can help out a little bit. I'm not, you know, look, I'm not a certified, you know, counselor by any means, but I've been through some rough crap, man, for sure.
and I might be able to help this guy out. You know, I'd certainly be willing to at least have a couple, you know. Well,
the problem with that is that, you know, and I agree, I'd be more than happy to talk to anybody. But the problem with that is that there's two different types of suicidal, in my opinion. Suicidal, you can be suicidal because you're depressed about what's going on, things aren't turning out your way, you know, but there's another type of suicidal where that is, you feel that is the only way out. You feel so bad, there is no hope. You just feel so bad. That's the point. You feel bad. And that's definitely a counselor, and definitely go get some help, go get some meds, go get 72-hour stays, seek professional help. That's what that is. But, you know, everyone's been through tough times, I'm sure, but if they need professional help, they need professional help.
He is seeing a psychiatrist, but what we learn in counseling is that it's like he's at least reaching out. And it's the people that don't talk about it that end up killing themselves. And you're like, you never know that they knew they were thinking about that, right? So at least give him props for reaching out. You know what I mean?
Right.
Hey, let me jump out of the norm here. Hey, Brian, quick. A quick question for you is anyone in the chat here asking any questions about some things that, you know, need to be addressed really quick?
Listen,
it's concerning, it's alarming. Hey, Corey, if this guy needs my help, give him my my contact. You know, I'd certainly be willing to go ahead and jump on the line with the guy. Yeah. You know, maybe I can. I mean, look, no promises, but you know, I can at least talk to him. Maybe. Yeah.
I'm sorry, I didn't mean to cut you off. Preliminal was saying prayer for Gil or Jill, wisdom, inner peace, protection from any harm. And R1 said, no suffering isn't required to obtain this. We have it already and don't realize it. Life matters. Everyone does, not just those who believe. So,
you know, let me tell you guys, you know, there's a lot of people out there that you know, they don't know how to go about reaching out. You know, it's hard. You know, if you don't know what this whole thing is all about, It could be frightful. When I first learned about it, you know, the first thought that went through my head was that I'm dead. You know, and I'll be honest with you, you know, I thought I was dead. And it could be because
this is his journey, Troy. You have to understand this is his journey. Okay, and he has to do it himself. He could reach out, people could be there. My sister committed suicide, okay? And you could reach out all you want. It's not going to stop a person from doing what they want to do. This is his own journey, and he has to fight it, and he has to overcome it.
Right, it's but you can't just say, I get it, but you know what? I'm not like that. I'm not built like that, you know, and I can't just say this is your own journey and you know, and let you do whatever you're going to do, because, you know, we all have if I would have helped, you know, built into it.
I was there for my sister day and night, but that didn't stop her from taking her life. Okay, you can do so much, but it's still their journey. You know, you can lend an ear and you can tell them that you love them and you're always here for them, but they're always going to do what they want to do. See, this is his challenge in life, and he's going to get through it. He will get through it. No matter what anybody says. She'll make him feel better for an hour, or two, or 3 days, and then he's going to go back to thinking the same thing when life throws him a curveball. It's something he's going to have to overcome. It's his challenge. Okay, maybe that's his purpose this time around. Maybe in a prior life he did commit suicide. This time around, maybe he's going to take a different path.
No, I agree with you, caller, but you, for me personally, you got to keep trying. You can't stop.
Yeah.
Like
I'm with you, Corey. You know, and again, you know, that's what you do, because you don't want to say, well, I'll give my, you know, I'm gonna let this guy take his own path and then take his own life. No. You know, that's when you gotta be most doting. I've lost two of my good friends, unintentional suicide, I guess you could say, you know, but you know, I've lost two of them.
you know, and I do. I think about that a lot, and I see, you know, I mean, I you know, I look back at myself. I'm like, man, did I do everything I possibly could? And I can feel okay that I think I did, you know. But on the same hand, it's like, could I have done more? Maybe, you know, I could have, you know, shit, I don't know, follow the guy around or something, you know. But the thing is that you're right, you know, when it comes down, you got to let the guys take their own path. But you know what? It does. It's gonna get you. If you have something that's so attached to you and you love them dearly, you're gonna do whatever it takes, and you don't want to have that, well, what if, you know, stuck in the back of your head. And I do. You know, no, and it's a sucky thought.
No, well, being a counselor, like, I know personally, I've had people that ended their lives, and I tried the best I could to help them, and it happens. It just, like I said, you got to try your best to help them, at least.
And his name is Jill, yeah?
Yeah.
Hey, Jill. Okay. Can I speak?
Hi, Melissa.
Oh, of course, honey.
Can I speak,
Melissa,
everyone?
Will you help us with her?
Well, can I say something first?
Of course, yes, honey. Go ahead.
I just want everyone to think for a minute, if there aren't multiple realities that we're living in, and this is the only reality that we have, and your best friend in the whole world, the person that you love more than anyone, is sitting there in front of you depressed and suicidal, are you not going to reach your hand out to help them, to pull them out of the depths of hell? Are you not going to do what it's going to take to help them?
Everything.
You can't do that. You can't think that there's another reality or there's another life for them. If they're standing in front of you and they need help being pulled out of the water, give them a hand. I'm not saying for you to go into the water yourself and not be able to breathe. I'm just saying if you're able to help them, if you're able to give them that hand, and it doesn't matter if it's something physical, mentally, emotional, or if you have to pray for them every single day all the time because of what they're going through, it's better to help and know that you've done what you could do to the extent of your own ability than it is to turn your back on them and walk away thinking that there's another them in another world.
Yeah.
We can't have that kind of thought now, because our life right now is important to us, and we are who we are. And we can't.
I swear to God, you just took the words out of my mouth. I mean, like,
you can do. You can try as much as you can try, but then you can't blame yourself.
Yeah.
You can't. You're right. You cannot blame yourself, but you need.
You know, my sister left two boys behind, and I've tried, you know, and there's nothing I could have done. I mean, I blamed myself. I was like, why didn't I pick up the phone? I was in nursing school. She committed suicide, that I know. Why didn't I stay with her that night? You know, I did the best that I could, but it was her choice.
Well, and you have to also. You have to also remember, with people that are suicidal or depressed in a suicidal state, some of them, it's attention. It's over and over again. They just want attention. That's all. They're trying. They've not learned positive attention. They've learned negative attention. So some of it's just feeding them positive attention by, like, you are so much more than this. You are the Lord's favorite person. And just encouraging them that way.
Some of them you can't help. Some of them you can't reach. Some of them, there's nothing you can do.
Right.
And that's what I'm talking about. There's some of them you can, and you get the time to figure it out, and you can't. You can't.
Yep.
Like, you have to talk to them all. You have to try your best with all of them.
Yeah.
Well, you know, from that perspective, I get you, but, you know, I don't want to be the one reading my best friend's obituary.
Right.
You know, or, well, you know.
My older brother committed suicide many, many years ago. And it has to be, you know, I mean, everyone's very sad. But the thing is that we're still sad. We're still, there's no note, there's no reason, there's no nothing. But there's nothing. It was just very, very, very bad, gut-wrenching. And, but my take on it, even from that time, 20 years ago now, 19, 18 years ago, whatever it was, reprehensible. It's reprehensible. It hurt everyone to the core. Everyone. It hurts everyone to this day. No, they just can't believe it. It's totally against who he was, totally against what he stood for, totally against everything. that he did. We attributed to 1,000 things: mental illness, drug abuse, alcohol abuse, bad life, bad time, bad. We don't. No one knows. To this day, no one knows. No one understands.
And you know, you're right. But you know, in the same hand, you know, I mean, we have to endure. You know, we're going through some pretty, you know, intense things right now. All of us guys, we don't know what the hell's going on. We don't. You know, we can't put a finger on it. We can't say it's one thing in particular. We don't know. But the thing is that one thing we do know is that we have to endure. We have to, you know, we have to trudge on and sally forth and get through this thing, guys. And we're the only family that we've got. You know, you guys have reached out, and, you know, we are the family. And whether it be, you know, who knows? It could be we are the bloodline of Enoch, you know. And that's what I'm hoping for, is that we actually, you know, we're the light warriors. We have something, you know, some greater purpose. We can't just say, oh, that's it. I'm throwing down my sword and I'm done. You know, that's it. No,
That's an interesting point that you brought up, because that's all I've been thinking for the last few days. As I talked to Melissa or talked to Brian, I just can't help but think there's got to be something else going on.
We are the light warriors, you guys, and I'm convinced on that. That we have a greater purpose, and if we have to battle, fuck, count me in. Sorry for cursing, but, you know, count me in. Let me do this. You know what? Listen, if this is going to be this crazy, I'm ready to battle. Let's go. You know, count me in. And I've already sworn my allegiance to my father. I've said many times, you know, he's helped me out so many times through so many, you know, right, horrible situations. I'm going to do it. I'm going to do it. I don't care what I'm going up against. Sorry, Ty. But I'm going to go up against whatever you give me. I don't care if it's like, you know, a 1,000-foot beast. I'm going to attack. If I may die, and you know, I may be obliterated and smash into chili. But guess what, guys? I'm gonna do it. I'm going to. I'm ready. Let's do it.
Come on. Put up that map for a minute so everybody can see it. I found this map. Remember that futuristic thing I was looking, and I found a good rendition of what's been repeated over and over again on YouTube, and then the futuristic viewpoint of how the map or how the future countries should look.
They supposedly have this at every military installation too.
Look at this thing. Look at where you are. Look at where you are, Troy. Look at where you are, Melissa. Look where Meeks would be. Look where you would be, Corey. Teresa, you're gone. Nevada's gone. California's gone. Right up through St. Louis, Missouri, right up through where you are, Melissa, Indiana. I mean, you can just see, look at all that. Look at where you are, Brian, right up through there. Look at that. Every single one of you guys are affected. Every single one. But there I am. Me, I'm okay.
Wait. What am I looking at?
What you're looking at is a futuristic map of the United States as repeated over and over again. There's many similarities to the same map from people giving their rendition of what they saw in the future, what they think is going to happen in the future, whatever the cause may be. This guy is the Philadelphia experiment guy, but it doesn't matter. They all look eerily similar, as I'm sure Harold's probably seen this 100 times. But look at those things. It's crazy. It's where everybody is, except Harold and me. I think, Harold, you're a little bit safer over there in Amish country. But everyone else seems to be terribly affected. That's you, Brian. That's you, Melissa. That's you, Troy, Teresa. And I believe, where did you say you were?
Well,
Corey?
Who are you asking?
Corey. Corey says up in Canada. He said he was in
Canada. It's Ottawa, right?
Ottawa.
This is extremely disturbing. Okay.
Right. And all the futuristic maps look similar to this. They all do.
Troy's on the lead.
But you know, though, is you know, guys, I think we're gonna live. Too. I think we're gonna live because we've already persevered this far, right? You know, I mean, come on, guys. I mean, there's 144,000 of us apparently that are seeing this, right?
I think this is exactly why we need prayer, because this whole thing could be prevented in the heart.
So one thing, let me tell you guys one thing, and this may resonate with some of you and may not make any sense to anyone else. But as I mentioned before, you know, one of my buddies, his name is Regatto. You know, we now work together, and you know, we still see the same kind of you know, personalities that that will try to attack one or the other of us. And when we get together, we see, you know, more people coming up to us and asking us what we're talking about out of the clear blue, and we even mention it of what we're talking about, and they get offended immediately, and then they run away. But I noticed that I didn't have that before. I get more of a conflict. But now that I have him right next to me, the people run away. And I can't explain it because I haven't seen that kind of dynamic yet. Now, just imagine if all of us were together. And I don't know how to explain it, but maybe there's, you know, something underlying all this, that if what if we were all to be together, you know, at one point in time, the enlightenment and what may happen. You know, so my belief is that if we were to take, you know, what is perceived as the 144, you know, and maybe a countdown to figure out, you know, the count up or whatever, to figure out who is really genuinely seeing what we're seeing and not just, you know, kind of chiming in and just being a troll or whatever. You know, I can only imagine the people that would come up to us and say anything to the contrary, because I think there would be the great fear that you don't even mess with us, because guess what? We do have the great light, and we've been, you know, and I'm not going to go as far as saying that we are the chosen ones, but you know what? I would imagine that there's got to be something to that, you know, and I would imagine that.
Troy, where did you come up with the term light bearer from?
I'm not even sure. You know, I've seen it somewhere, but it kind of resonates with me. That there's got to be something to it. I'm not exactly where, you know, I heard this, but you know, it's making more and more sense to me that this is the direction that I have to really kind of pursue. It's one of those things that, you know, it just makes more sense than anything for me. So I think that there's a 144,000 light warriors. And whether or not it be true or not, I think that it's worth exploring. And that's the only thing that I'm really kind of going towards right now. And I think that it really makes more sense than, you know, we're all just going through some madness. There's a reason for it. And I think that, you know, I've already seen it firsthand with just one additional person next to me that is actually, you know, going through exactly what I'm going through is powerful. And I've seen it firsthand. Just one. Right. So just imagine one times, you know, 144,000. I bet we could say, don't even mess with us. I guarantee you there's going to be a whole lot of problems, and who knows what's going to, resonate at that point in time. But I guarantee you it's going to be a powerful force.
Together, what we have is called synergy, I think. When we combine ourselves together, when we come together and we discuss this stuff, We are stronger willed, and we're not going to give up. We're not going to throw down the cards.
But we got to get to 144,000 of what it comes down to, and there's going to be a lot of fakes in the mix.
It doesn't mean that we have to play their game, of course, whatever game it is they're trying to play with us. But it just means that we see all the hands now, and that means we can possibly win and beat this thing.
And that being said, is that
how did you come across 144,000? How did you ascertain
that? I'm not even sure, Ty.
Okay,
that was Troy's, not mine.
Yeah, no, I'm not even sure. All I know is that apparently there was 144,000 people that were.
But I do. I do.
Yes,
we're not. I do know what it is, but I was just asking where you came up with that yourself. And I was wondering if it was something that you got from Regatto, or it was something that you picked up from someone
else. Not from Regatto. I don't recall, but you know, I don't remember. But I know that it's something that resonates with me. That is that there's got to be 144,000, and we got to get the pure, you know, the people that are actually truly seeing things. And I know there's a lot of, I guess we can consider them trolls, I guess, that are here to observe us. And they're going to be here to role play.
Well, I think
I'm not here to entertain a role player. You know, these are people that are truly experiencing this, and we're going to get a lot of them, and they're not going to be, you know, listen, they're going to try to go ahead and you know, and jump on in and you know, throw a wrench into the works, if you will, you know, to, you know, kind of play the role and be intrigued about what's going on and just play the game. But this is not a game, guys. This is not a game. This is not a fad. This is not something that is, you know, fun. If you think this is what this is, you are on the wrong channel. You're on the wrong stream, guys.
This
is something that's really happening, and it's really going to go down. And guess what? I really think that if you're here for the sheer entertainment to figure out what's going on, well, guess what? You're going to get some good entertainment. But, you know, the fact is that, you know, that's not what this is all about. I'm here to – me personally, I'm here to help you guys. I want to be here with all my family because you guys are my family. It's all, you guys are the only family that I have. I've lost everything else. Believe me. You know, I have to tell you this.
Let's not forget about other people too, like Meegs and Serenity. We gotta pray for them too, because they do talk about being spiritually attacked, or what's that term? Singled out, attacked. I feel sorry gang for stalking. People who are getting gang stalking. Yeah, what is up with that? I feel sorry for people that are experiencing that right now, and that is a real thing, by the way.
And guess what, guys? Let me tell you something. The big picture is this. You know, look, you know, we see, I think, all these little symbols that we're seeing, like logo changes and all these little anomalies. That's fine. Okay, you guys can see those, and they may be intriguing and fun for you to see, you know, or like, oh, let's just beat that to death. You guys are missing the point. These are just little droplets to say, wake up, wake up, wake up, wake up, wake up. You guys are not getting it. The point is, there's something much bigger than just seeing, like, oh, look, you know, the color chartreuse is now pink. No, it's not that, guys. You guys are missing it.
Troy, I just want to say something here. I think that each one of us is responsible for the people around us, okay? And, you know, sometimes when you're talking about these big numbers and big things, that's true. All of that is true, but it's more important to think about the people that are around us, okay? And we have to look out for each other, you know? It's like, you know, okay, you know, yes, we are seeing things that other people don't see. Yes, we're responsible for those things. And yes, you know, we're in a bigger dispensation. However, you know, we're also responsible, like, I'm responsible for Ty. Ty's responsible for me. I'm responsible for Brian. Brian's responsible for me. And we got to look out for each other, you know, because, look, we're all that we have, and we're facing some pretty scary things, okay? I mean, you know, things are people are getting hit on a daily basis, and people are struggling because they see these things. You know, for me and you, yeah, we're strong. Ty's strong. Brian's strong. But there are people that see these things and don't know what to do about it. I mean, they're freaked out. You know, the first moment you find out that you're not in the same place in the universe, or that your country has moved, or, you know, that a couple of billion people just disappeared, you know, and you don't know where they went, you get freaked out, you know. And these things are happening, just like we looked at Australia, and a big chunk of Australia is just missing. Where did it go? Where did the people go that lived there? You know, did they just disappear? Did they just die? Did they go to some other reality? We don't know, okay? But what I do know is that we have to stand with the people that are around us, and we have to help. Each person has to, you know, hold hands with the next person and lift that person up. And that's how we survive. And that's the only way we're going to survive. It isn't I realize there's this big dispensation that we have to deal with, and all this other stuff that we have to deal with. But, you know, we're responsible for each other, man. And if we don't look out for our brothers and sisters around us, there ain't going to be a big dispensation, okay?
Well, it ain't going to happen. I hope that I was being unclear by saying there was some kind of divide You know, yeah. So if you know, I wasn't sure if that was you know, anything that I was insinuating.
Let me revisit that
because that's not at all what I was actually saying. My point was is that, you know, you guys are the only family that I have, you know, and I know that everyone here that is going through their own personal, you know, tribulations and experiences and all these weird anomalies. Guess what, guys? You have found the right place to talk about this. This is like the key forum. There's a lot of people out there that are thinking monetarily, oh, let's just take advantage of all these weird things that are going on. Let's just put them out there and like make some weird money. Now, I can't discredit them because, you know, listen, a lot of these people are talking a lot of truth about things that are going on and they're making money for it. That's fine. That's fine. But, you know, if they have an inspirational message that they're trying to, you know, kind of, you know, tour guide you through, you know, and you know, preach the whatever they're doing, that's fine. I get it. But the moment that they start saying things that are, you know, they're trying to pull you off in some different directions, you really got to be skeptical of what you're listening to. Because, you know, listen, if they start pulling you away from the key focus, which is God, you know, my Father, you know, and you know, the Creator, this whole thing has awakened me because I wasn't such a good guy, guys. I wasn't a great guy. I was a total, I mean, I wasn't saying I was a total dick, but I mean, I wasn't a great guy. I went to catechism and I did all the other things. You know, I was a rocker and I did like, I wasn't doing like, you know, Satan worship by any means, but, you know, I did the Ouija board and stuff. You know, I wasn't that kind of, I wasn't the purebred guy. I wasn't like walking around like, you know, like the purebred guy. I wasn't. No. I'll be honest and straight with you guys. I'm not going to BS you and say I'm like, you know, straight from some kind of like, you know, some holy place. But, you know, you guys, I realized after all this stuff and I came to realization that there is a bigger power and there's something that I really have to awaken myself to. And I realized this, and it changed my whole belief system entirely. And you know what, guys? It's scary. It's so scary. Let me tell you, man.
No, Troy, I totally agree with you. And I wasn't close with God until the ME come up. Like, I was in Bible school as a kid, but, like, from 2016 on, like, I've been super, like, close to God. And I think that's the message, like, you were trying to say, is that I think we're all together, and we're also closer to God.
Correct. That's, Corey, thank you, man. Because, you know what, you know, guys, I've never been so humble in my life. I don't need to strive to make $1 million, because guess what, guys? I'm so humble, and I'm fine with that. I don't know what's going to come. I can't give you any promises, but you know what? You guys, you have me as your friend and, you know, and your family. And I promise you, if there's anything I could do, you know, I will certainly be there to, you know, at least advise. I don't know all the answers, but I can tell you what I know is that there's something that's much more impressive than you've ever seen in your life. And much more importantly is that we have to endure. This is the one thing you must understand, is that you can't just say, oh my God, it's all going to crap. No, listen, I get it. Things, I'm not naive to that. I'm not dumb. I get it. There's things that are happening, but maybe there's something greater for us here that we have to, you know, maybe spread the word and try to awaken those people. And I get it that we're going to have some, you know, some lash back, and we're going to get the people that are saying, hey, listen, don't stop talking about that. Well, guess what? This is testing our faith, guys. We have to do that. And I think
Amen, Troy. I think everybody's getting a little tired, Troy. Amen. You're absolutely right. Can I just break in here with a prayer?
Of course.
Yes, that's fine.
Absolutely.
Father in heaven, we just thank you that we were able to come together tonight and spend this time together and venting and talking and discussing. And we just thank you, Lord, that you continue to open the metaphors up to us and continue to let us see and hear, Lord, and the truth, Lord. And continue to guide us, Lord, in the right direction. Continues to keep us on that narrow path, Lord. Don't let us fall off. Don't let evil attack us, Lord. Protect us from those demons and those entities that come after every single one of us. And be there with us, Lord, and guide us. And there's a lot of people going through depression and suicidal thoughts right now, Lord, and we just ask you to wrap your loving arms around them and carry them through this so they know that they're loved, that everyone, every person knows how special they are, that they're God's favorite, most precious person in the world, and that they can find that love and feel that love from you, Lord. And we just ask you to anoint them with that tonight, Lord. And when I just want to thank you for all my brothers and sisters here listening and the ones that have participated in talking tonight, Lord, and how precious each one of them are. Every single one of us is different and gifted with a different gift. And I have been so blessed by them. And I just praise you for that. I give you all the glory, Lord, for everything. And I just thank you for everything you've done for me and all my brothers and sisters. You continue to pull us through and keep us safe. And you continue to watch over us and guide us and protect us. And you've given us platforms to be able to communicate above and beyond so that we don't feel so isolated and left alone, Lord. And we just praise you and we give you glory for that, Lord. And we thank you. And ongoing, Lord, we just ask you to continue to guide us. And Lord, we thank you. In Jesus' name, I pray.
Oh, amen for that, for sure. And you know, and I'll add, if I can add something, you know, may the white light of God's love guide us divinely to, you know, to our destination. And you know, we're all awaiting your kingdom, your paradise. We're here for you now. We understand there's a great creator, and we know you've shown. You showed us all that there's something more to be aware of, and you know, and whatever you want us to do, in this sense, you know, we're here with open ears, and please let our prayers be heard, you know, because we all want to know, we want to know that we're doing the right thing, you know, and I think that we're all doing exactly what we need to be doing at this very moment in time, and you know, God, amen. I love you. Love you.
Yes. Praise the Lord.
Amen.
Amen, guys. Good night. See you next week.
Good night. Thank you, everybody.
Good night.
Good night.
Good night.
Good night, guys. Love y'all.
Thank you.